0.
I guess welcome everybody to Seed Story Cup 5. This is...
Wasn't 0 rhetorical? Like, they need to actually count down as 0. It just says 1 and then it explodes.
Yeah.
So 0 is actually 1.
It's kind of 1, yeah, in Germany, I guess. So here we are, Seed Story Finals. Dan Azumoti JQT.
Dude, it's 1 a.m.
That's my name.
It's 1 a.m. already, and we're about to cast the Best 7 Life Coach series.
Yes, I know. I'm prepared for...
Some people have a flight in a few hours.
3 hours?
Some people have a flight in a few hours, too, which is why some people are sticking around to after the party.
I have a pickup at 5 a.m.
Yeah.
Nice.
So, hope you packed, because we're about to finish around that
time. I hope they actually finish before I have a pickup.
Yeah. Or we can make it quick. Maybe Life Coach decimates Jackie Chan. Maybe Jackie Chan sweeps him with some kind of cool, unusual deck.
If he doesn't ban Rogue, there is a chance that Life Coach will just sweep with Rogue.
Yeah.
But he probably will ban it. So. Yeah.
We haven't even seen the Warlock deck.
Oh,
I assume there's a Yogg-Saron somewhere in that Warlock deck that we
saw. You mean
saw.
Jackie's deck?
Jackie
Chan. And we didn't see at the very end of that series. It is Zyrez's Dragon Warlock, which plays Alexstrasza's Double Soulfire and Sunwalkers.
And probably Yogg-Saron. It's probably the tech. Why the Jackie Chan tech? The Jackie Chan tech.
I don't know. We got pretty deep into that deck. He life tapped a lot, and we
like 8 cards left.
Yeah.
We know the bans, by the way.
Okay.
We have Rogue banned for Life Coach.
Yeah, so that's very smart.
Yeah, that's something we expected because Rogue is pretty good versus Jackie Chan's lineup. And then Life Coach banned Shaman, which is Conceit Shaman.
Really?
So, Frodo, you had a lot of experience with that deck.
The Frost Giants are really scary, man.
Dude. Yeah, definitely a good ban.
And Life Coach said yesterday, he said he just doesn't know how to play against it. He said even if some of his decks are good against it, he doesn't know.
Not enough practice.
Not enough practice. And that's what Life Coach prides himself in, is being able to just play a deck a million times and analyze it a million times. And if he doesn't know, he'll just take it away.
And
ban it.
Especially at 1 a.m.
Especially at 1 a.m. Who wants to try and think when you can just ban?
It might actually be a factor. In fact, I do think it'll be a factor, some of that fatigue. So we have Druid, Warlock, Mage, Paladin, Druid, Shaman, Hunter, Warrior. Not only do we have class diversity here, which is really awesome, 7 classes amongst 8 decks.
We have Nazoth Paladin, which
which might repeat a tournament victory.
From Valencia.
Does this, and I asked this back at Valencia, does this cause us to reevaluate the state of Paladin currently in the metagame?
No, it still sucks.
It still sucks, but for tournament meta, does it cause us to rethink whether or not we should reconsider Paladin? TJ,
I think yes, because if you look at all the... Jackie Chan, I mean, has probably won, on average, over 2 games with Nazoth Paladin in every series. In some of his matches, he won 3 games.
I feel like that's
games.
That's a TJ stat.
That is a TJ stat.
AKA one that
everybody
just
knows
afford.
That TJ stats are only correct 34% of the time.
Right.
So, but yeah, I feel every time I watch him, I feel like he wins at least 2 games with Nazoth Paladin.
Okay.
He's definitely successful with Nazoth Paladin. Mm. But we also want to thank our sponsors before we go into the match.
Seamless.
Thanks, a Nish. Very seamless transition.
Flawless, Nish.
Yeah, but for everyone, for you guys, you still have a chance to get into the raffle if you go to the Facebook page.
Last chance.
Yeah, last chance to get to the raffle.
How do you do it, Nimsh?
How do you get to the raffle?
Yeah.
How would you do it if there is a raffle?
Well,
I guess you enter your details.
Your job? Okay, go to facebook.com/TakeTV. You see that big button? Wait, go back.
Oh.
See that big button that says SSC?
Okay, I guess
raffle?
The raffle is over.
Yeah, oh, no. Click on it and feel bad because you missed the promotion.
You just missed it. There was a
your
great chance to get
gone.
It.
So what you should do is get in the time machine, go back.
Go back and try to get in.
Fix all of my misplays. Call me and just remind me about how much of an idiot I am. And then enter the raffle for your chance to win all these cool prizes. And if not, you know what? I'm pretty sure we'll get another Seed Story Cup down the line. I don't want to promise for TakeTV, but we have so much fun, and I feel like you guys show up in force. Thank you so much, everyone who's tuned in to watch. We've had a blast, but a lot of it is because you guys tuned in to make this event worthwhile. We wouldn't really do it without you guys, so we really appreciate everyone's tuned in.
Yeah.
And we hope that this finals lives up to how much we've had fun and entertained you guys as well.
Yeah, definitely. I hope that the finals will be one of the best finals we'll have, because historically in Hearthstone, the semifinal is one of the best matches.
TJ, this is your first Seed Story Cup. Me and Nimsh have been here since the beginning, after the very first one, but this is your first one.
It's my first
how
one.
How did you enjoy it so far?
It was sick, man. just, you know, just for being here for 4 days, you know, a lot of people are all about the fun, but just absorbing information. There's 32 players here and, you know, a mix of some casters and some people that come out and play at a high level as well. Just absorb the amount of information I've absorbed over the past couple days has been absolutely ridiculous.
Wait, what about the main thing about the C3 Cup? How much alcohol have you absorbed?
Not much.
Oh, man.
I'm not a big drinker, Nimsh. I hate to ruin the party.
This is kind of a man's privacy, you know? You don't have to talk too much about that on stream.
But I get drunk off of good old water.
TJ's actually been pretty serious about playing some Hearthstone. He's been learning a lot, and I'm pretty sure he's got a lot to say about some of these matchups. Oh, snap. I'm getting a massage from my father.
We have a visitor.
From dad himself.
We have a visitor. This is Forsen.
Who's that mysterious
guy? Can't even see him. There he is.
Yo.
Forsen was
dude?
Just in the arm wrestling match, by the way.
Well,
Forsen, did you win your arm wrestling match?
Actually, you know what I said? I said we should have an arm wrestling competition.
I did.
So that you'd win something.
Yeah,
I saw that guy.
I have a couple of pictures of
you that. You almost beat him. That guy's so huge. Yeah.
What? Yeah, almost. He destroyed you.
You play Overwatch all day and read donations. How are you supposed to beat him?
He had his hand behind his back, and you were holding onto the table.
Yeah.
Jackie Chan?
Yeah, Jackie made the finals, dude.
The actor?
No, the UK Hearthstone player.
Oh, my God.
You never even know. You don't know who Jackie Chan is. He's like a 2 to 3K Hearthstone.
He's both Hearthstone player and an actor.
So yeah, you should consider networking. You know, people who stream with the same number should stick together.
Just not right now. He's busy.
Yeah, he's trying to. Well, don't enter the cabin.
Okay, Forsen says Life Coach is gonna win. Yeah. Nick says he has a flight in like 4 hours, something like that.
Yeah,
so,
estimate is 4 hours, more or less.
Yeah. No worries. Yeah. Well, check back with us later, Forsen. Thanks,
man. See you, Forsen.
She's Forsen.
All right. DJ, sorry about that. You're about to introduce us with some serious Hearthstone knowledge. So, out of all of the knowledge that you've been able to absorb, drop me with some dank insight about this Paladin versus Druid matchup.
Well, the way Jackie Chan has played Paladin versus Druid is just to draw the nuts and win the first match. That seems to be his strategy going into this matchup. But Life Coach, I don't know. It feels like Life Coach has lost like every single first matchup with Druid. He lost in the semifinals. He lost in the quarterfinals in his first match with Druid both times.
Is that a TJ stat?
That's a TJ stat. 100% of the time, Life Coach loses with Druid in the first game.
Oh, man. You really noted that?
Yeah. I'm like 64% sure.
I respect that. But this time, it seems like he actually has a good hand, and he might win this one, where Jackie...
Well,
okay.
It's not that impressive.
I mean, there's a lot of lines to take there. Life Coach is, of course, thinking about how he can curb out every single turn and place minion threats. So if he coined Innervate Teacher, Wild Growth doesn't guarantee anything for 4 mana. Coin Wild Growth does guarantee Innervate Azure Drake into the Violet Teacher, and then hopefully you pick up anything from turns 4 onwards to play, maybe even opportunity to play early Thorsen with another ramp.
Yeah.
And you want to be fast in this matchup. You want to kill Paladin before he assembles all the parts.
Jackie's just spinning 360.
Dude, there was one time he played Yogg and he literally put his hands on his head and just spun around twice.
I like it. It's the Yogg ritual. Yeah.
It's like a voodoo thing.
Yeah.
Maybe it helps. Who knows?
He's just, man. Even from his first win, he was the only player that after his first win, like, jumped up with joy. Well, there was two players, Jackie Chan and Frodan.
I know that Blizzard promised. That was awesome reference, by the way. I know that Blizzard promised that, but they didn't promise. Sorry, I know Blizzard kind of implied that they weren't sure if they're going to make a card after Oskaka. They did make a card after Firebat because they say you always remember your first. But for Oskaka, they said they weren't sure if they're going to make a card for him.
Why?
But if Jackie were to win BlizzCon this year, and Blizzard were to make a card after him, I would hope it's something like Yogg's Chosen, but you would kind of make it a pun on Jackie's name, because Jackie Chan is the chosen son of Yogg-Saron. Would you guys agree? Disagree?
Jackie Chan?
You tried, Nymph.
This is your forte. Make a pun out of Jackie Chan's name that could be used in a Yogg-Saron.
That's your homework for the next tournament.
Yeah.
All right. I'll prepare it. Yeah. 4 games come.
I like the ramp. Sets up for Emperor. Discarding Fandral and Nourish means that for 7 mana, you can play both. So turn 6, Emperor. Turn 7, Fandral and Nourish. Life Coach is playing very well right now, despite it being very late.
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah, he's doing a great job. And Jackie has to draw the cards. But he already has Consecration, the Pyromancer. That might be good. Yeah. Quality as well. There is removal. A lot of it, actually.
Yeah, that's actually pretty huge, too. Because no matter how big Drew can build the board, you can play as many Power of the Wilds in your hand. If your deck was 30 Power of the Wilds, or 29 Power of the Wilds in Fandral, that's cool. I still have Pyromancer with quality, or quality Consecration, and I can draw cards.
Well, the one card that Life Coach does have in his deck that's sort of like the key card in this matchup, and he said it was specifically designed to beat sort of the control matchup, so Soul of the Forest. Because Soul of the Forest just lives through removal. No matter what kind of wild Pyromancer shenanigans you have, it's almost impossible to clear a board that has Soul of the Forest on it. So he sacrifices Savage Roar, so he's not going to be able to win as quickly, but he can win in the long game just because of that card. He's always going to have something stick.
That's not the only card he sacrificed from this deck. Because this
Yogg's
deck is
Duran.
Yeah, that's one. He did actually sacrifice. Yeah.
Life Coach cut Yogg's.
Yeah, he did cut Yogg's.
So did Tice.
Life Coach
so
was so RDU. High. Life Coach, RDU, and Tice were so high on my favorite players' tier list in Hearthstone, and now they just dropped the huge pegs.
Yeah. These guys are like opposites in every way. It's like order versus chaos.
I like it.
Jackie Chan is
Except
chaos.
That, you know, like I feel like Jackie Chan is like a chaotic good. He's definitely not a chaotic neutral or evil.
Chaotic good is good for him, for sure. Yeah. With how he smiles and how he approaches the game.
Yeah. And Life Coach is like a lawful good. He actually like does so many. He's like motivated so much in life based off like what he feels is correct and like as a like a morally ethically thing to do.
I would say like, he's lawful neutral because of the roping.
That like brings it closer to the middle.
His alignment gets to the middle.
Yeah.
Because like for example, the Xfinity Hearthstone Invitation. Remember we casted that? They like asked him to cast it last second, and they just basically said like we really need a caster because we don't have anyone else. And he said okay, and he basically like almost did the event for free because of that.
Yeah.
Like which is just like he does things because he really wants to help people. That's just like his biggest calling in life.
Yeah.
And
his name is Life Coach.
One of the tournaments he won, he actually like, just gave the prize to the chat. He's like, I don't need
really?
This. Yeah, that was like $100 for the win. And he's like, I don't need this money. I just want to give it to the chat.
So he gave it to like the random viewers?
Yeah, I think it was even Deck Wars, like a duel. It's like, I just wanted to play it for pleasure.
What a guy.
What a good human being.
I'm going to host a tournament, get prize pool from sponsors, and invite Life Coach and then a bunch of bad players. So Life Coach will give the prize money to me.
You get to keep your money. You That's sound nice like every scheme. Tournament organizer in esports.
Yep.
Just genuine. Kidding. Just kidding. We have some good people like TTV running it, thankfully. So how do you remove this? Because you definitely can't leave up Fandral and Emperor. I mean,
Is this board worth using the combo, the Equality Consecration? Because you haven't even seen a Violet Teacher yet. So if you use it now, then that sort of gives Life Coach the green light to start building a big board. So Jackie Chan has to be afraid. I mean, he does have other things that he could do. I mean, he has like a lot of activators, but only one Equality. But you're very vulnerable for the next couple turns, especially since you're two turns away from either your Rags, if you use your combo now to clear the board.
How about a fancy play where you say, sure, you discount your entire hand multiple turns, and I can't do anything about it, so I just let you keep playing the board, and then I remove it next turn. I was actually even thinking about True Silver and then like kind of attacking to kind of set up just a consecration, but yeah. I mean,
I
this
like
is
it.
Fine, too.
Because like you can get so much value later from your removal cards that you'll be ahead anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, but speaking of value... Oh, that is a lot of ability to just benefit off of Fandral, which does play really well into the Equality Consecration.
Well, if he picks up another card that is Fandral activated, another choose one, this turn could be insane.
You probably keep Violet Teacher in hand.
Yeah, probably. Oh, yeah. So you just play the Drake instead, get the spell power.
Maybe start with Double Wrath on the 6-6.
Double Wrath on the 6-6.
You could play Azure Drake, Blood Mage.
And Wrath.
And then Wrath.
That seems pretty reasonable. You have, like, a sizable board.
Yeah. But we're going to start up with a Wrath.
It's safer, for sure.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to overextend, and you want to bait out AoE as well. And those two cards, they do bait out AoE.
Yeah. I mean, Fandral and Thorsen by themselves are pushing 8 damage a turn. So why do you need to even play anything else?
Oh, there's Soul of Forest
Soul
now.
Soul of Forest.
That changes things.
Which is just outside the range of Pyro Quality Consecration. Wow, and Life Coach didn't get roped. Very clean play.
Surprisingly.
Yeah.
I mean, he's usually able to get out of it, but the times where he doesn't usually ends up a disaster.
I asked Life Coach right before the game if he was afraid of Jackie Chan's decks because of how wacky they are. And he told me he's not afraid of Jackie Chan or his decks. He's afraid of himself. He's afraid of misplaying. So that sort of gives Life Coach's mentality on the game overall. He's not worried about what his opponent's doing. He's only worried about what he's doing.
Interesting.
Yeah. It's similar to Tice.
Sounds like a Korean StarCraft player.
Tice, after the match with Life Coach, was super upset after one play he didn't make.
Yeah.
Even though he should be really happy about the match. Like, the match was awesome.
Yeah.
So what do you do here, then? Can you even bother clearing it?
With the first Consecration?
He's just going to pyro really quality while he can, but
this means still
there's
eight power
remaining. And if your opponent has Savage Roar, you're dead.
Well, Savage Roar is not in this deck, so Raven Idol, possibly, because I think Soul of the Forest is being played instead of Savage Roar.
He does have 13. Swipe, though. Oh, Power of the Wild!
Oh,
this is 8
that's
plus
it.
4.
That's
12,
it.
Yeah. So Paladin is dead!
And my stat was wrong!
Why are you guys yelling?
TJ stats!
Hey, this is exciting!
You're not answering my question.
I was expecting Paladin to sweep.
Really? You were expecting Paladin to sweep?
Well, it's a bad deck that's in the final, so anything can happen.
Yeah.
You guys are haters in the Paladin.
Well, I like
that he wanted the Paladin to sweep.
No, you said he thought he would sweep.
But then
he called it a bad deck.
And I also kind of wanted it to sweep, because then people will play it another, and I could climb faster.
Yeah.
It's okay. Paladin has been instrumental to getting Jackie to this point, to the finals.
Yeah.
Now he has Druid, Warlock, Mage. Up against the Druid.
Druid.
I would either assume that his Druid or Warlock comes out here. I wouldn't assume the Mage comes out.
Well, he had success with the Warlock against Naaman's Druid, but it was a pretty bad opening for Naaman. He didn't have a play until turn 4, he ramped, and then didn't even have another play until like turn 7. Had to play an early Yogg, so I don't know if that's a good representation. So Jackie Chan's going to trust in the Tempo Mage to go ahead and beat this. I like this deck against Druid.
That's interesting, because I know that Eloise said just half an hour ago. She's played a lot of games with Tempo Mage.
One of the worst matchups, for the Tempo Mage.
The Tempo Mage that Eloise plays is a lot different than the Tempo Mage that Jackie Chan plays.
Okay.
Yeah, but still, if Druid cheats, you can't really do anything about it. And right now, Jackie Chan missed the coin. So I think it will be a tough ride for Jackie Chan.
Yeah. And that's not a good opening hand for Jackie Chan either.
That's not something you want.
I mean, Flamewaker's almost never something you keep unless you have a perfect hand otherwise.
He was looking for free twos, basically.
Yeah.
And then Life Coach can keep Raven Idol and then mulligan the rest. You're looking for Innervate, Wild Grove. Oh, he even throws away Raven Idol. I think there are like two schools. Like, some people want to keep Raven Idol to try to get Innervate or Wild Grove, where some want to have Raven Idol as the late game card.
It's kind of it's kind of okay, because you can actually find a Wild Growth and play it on turn 2.
Yeah.
But if you're on the coin, one, you get an extra mulligan, so you can find a natural Wild Growth. And two, Raven Idol into Wild Growth is not as effective because you're on the coin.
And late game, Wild Growth is, Raven Idol is great late game, because then you can have a speciality pick like Savage Roar or Soul of the Forest or whatever you need at a specific moment.
Finds you answers.
You guys are so smart. I agree. Well, if there's one thing we also agree on, is Life Coach doesn't have a good play this turn. Just hero power pass. Also known as Plant Face Druid.
Yeah.
Where you hit your opponent in the face with your hero power.
I'm telling you, man. Jessikar has a place in Druid.
I was actually thinking Jessikar would shine.
I played against a Jessikar Druid. That is scary.
Wait,
he caught play a Jessikar Trueheart against me. Druid versus Warrior.
He had Fandral and Raven Idol, and he played Raven Idol and for a minion. He gets both, and he got Jessikar.
That was scary.
When Jessikar got announced, I was like, yeah, it's going to be played in Druid for sure, because you can innervate it early, and you can use the hero power from turn 4 or whatever.
Yeah,
except you never really want to be stuck hero powering too much as Druid.
All right, Dan, quiz time. What's the name of the upgraded hero power from Jessikar Trueheart for Druid?
So it's shapeshift, so it's like, it's gotta be like dire shift or something like that.
Dan is
dire shapeshift.
Shift shape?
Dan is a genius.
Is dire shape?
Dire Shapeshift. That's correct.
Nice. I didn't even know.
Good job.
The hardest of reads on TJ. I like it.
So here at Life Coach, I think you just go for Mana Crystal.
From the Mire Keeper.
Yeah.
Ramps you to 5. So you have Azure Drake next turn. Or Nourish. Most likely Azure Drake.
Yeah.
How much of a threat is that that Flame Waker, though?
So what can you expect next turn? Arcane Intellect?
Yeah, or just anything that hits it, like Arcane Blast, Frostbolts. You can develop 2 mana minions behind it. Just feels really scary.
But then you're losing too much if you want to kill it with Double Wrath.
I mean, you're losing a coin. You still have 4 mana plays.
Oh, he's going for the Double Wrath.
Yeah. Okay, I don't mind that.
This deck doesn't run that many threatening minions that can be easily dealt with like Wrath. So Flame Waker is just about the best target that you could utilize your removal on. Yeah. One of the reasons why, especially in like mid-range Shaman, one of the best X targets is Flame Waker and Temple Mage. So
yeah, I completely agree with this play. Flame Waker is way too threatening. It's like the oil to the engine. The real engine is just like the fact that you're able to get so much tempo through spells like Fireball or Arcane Blast, but the thing that really pushes it through is... Actually, maybe the analogy is backwards. The engine is the Flame Waker and the oil is the spells.
Yeah.
That really makes it go. Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry. But you guys knew what I was talking about.
What came first, the engine or the oil?
The oil, question. Actually, because Flame Waker came in 2014 or 15.
Yeah, the spells were in the very beginning of Hearthstone.
Yeah. I guess you're right.
Life Coach went for the 3-3 Mana Crystal to be able to play Thorazon maybe next turn. Like, his hand is not that exciting with no spells. Yeah. No
7 oil. Missiles, really likely that you kill this 3-3. You get 2 from the Arcane Intellect, you get 5 from the Arcane Missiles.
Seems good.
And
5 now.
You get to set up the cleanest board for the Face of Summoner.
Like, really worst case scenario, you will attack with a minion into it, but...
You'd have to lose 4 out of 5 coin flips, so... Or at least 4 out of 5 coin flips. You can also lose 5. That's pretty low chances, like sub 10%. So,
yeah. And Life Coach is going to play Emperor, but how much damage is he going to take?
A lot.
Before he can start getting stuff out of his hand. Whoa!
Oh, man. This is 12 damage
That's
plus 4.
Brutal. That's brutal. Is that even, like, potential lethal?
17, 20. That is lethal.
Jesus.
Holy moly.
Just like that.
It's time to yell again. Somebody won.
Somebody won, yeah. Excitement.
I feel like you've been hanging out with Jockey a little too much, TJ.
He's been sleeping the whole weekend.
That's
no joke.
Probably of the jet
lag. You tell you to yell at every
lag.
Game.
I bet you $150. Actually, $155 that Chalky's sleeping downstairs right now.
I don't want to give you $150.
$155.
A lot of the NA players, a lot of the NA, because we're counting in euros. Because a lot of the NA players have actually been super jet lagged. Rena like went to bed at like 11 a.m. yesterday. Yeah. A lot of the guys were just kind of chilling.
Yeah.
Well, European players were jet lagged.
Actually, Chalky's right there. Oh my god, that scared me.
Wow.
You should have taken the call. He was actually right behind
us. I knew Chalky was awake. I went downstairs and I saw him just watching the broadcast. Okay. And stuff.
So you win some money then?
No, we didn't. He didn't take the
bet. I'll give you my PayPal.
I was here, TJ. I've heard everything.
Series attack 1-1, and we're going to go to Mage up against the Warrior. This is probably the worst matchup for Tempo Mage.
Yes.
Just almost every variant of Warrior shuts it out. You have a lot of life gain as a C'Thun Warrior to make sure that burn doesn't become an issue. You have a lot of removal tools, so that way the early game threats aren't really that problem. And even in the instance where you play Yogg-Saron, Warrior is one of the classes most equipped to deal with Yogg-Saron post the apocalypse.
So again, you just want to be very fast, and you want to have the coin. Which Jackie-chan actually got this time.
I think previously, Temple Mage was decent against the classic Control Warrior because they didn't have as many minions early on to contest. They had to rely strictly on removal. It felt like if you missed Fire War Axe, you were in a rough spot. But nowadays, you have so many more early game plays. If you miss removal, you can still hit minions. You can still hit C'Thun's Chosen. You can still hit Beckoner of Evil. And it allows for a much smoother early game. So you go into the mid game with usually a lot more wiggle room, a lot more health to work with, which makes the matchup much more doable from the Warriors' side.
Temple Mate took a pretty big hit. They lost Mad Scientist, which consequently led them to play less Secrets, which means less tempo overall, making them play a lot more late-game oriented.
They lost Dr. Boom.
They lost Dr. Boom, but everyone lost Boom.
They did gain Cold Sorcerer, but Cold Sorcerer doesn't really do much in Warrior because Dice of Fire War Axe, the extra spell damage to couple with like Arcane Missiles or Arcane Blast, doesn't really do much against Warrior because you're not really trying to tempo them out. So the tools that they gained, with Yogg-Saron being an exception,
because Yogg-Saron is really good to refill your hand. But also it's like something so awkward to play Temple Mage versus Warrior because you want to play Mirror Images with Flame Waker, but you don't want to overextend to Brawl.
Yeah.
But then Water Elemental is really good. Mm. So this opening is quite nice for Jackie-chan.
Lifecoach is kind of hitting the same problem that I did earlier in the tournament where like you're not banning Warrior ever because you're banning Shaman all the time due to the fact that your strategy revolves around Rogue and a few of these classes to potentially sweep non-Shaman matchups. And as a result, because you have to account for Warrior being in the lineup, you have to play the greedy Doomcaller package in order to face off against other Warriors in the event you play the Mirror and they don't ban your Warrior. As such, you're more liable to these kinds of draws when you just get like Doomcaller or maybe like Emperor Thorazan. You don't really need them at all. You just want your early game tools. And right now, it's kind of awkward. He's just got so much heavy stuff that's not relevant for a long time.
Never Cthulhu plebs, baby rage.
Yeah, we saw it in the semifinals too. Life Coach almost lost the final game because he was stuck with minions. His whole hand was minions.
Yeah. Well, the most important part was that he didn't get the small Cthulhu buff.
Yeah.
And again, like the only thing that buffs Cthulhu here is the Doomcaller.
Yeah. Again, no minions.
Okay. Well, Slam is actually not too bad of a thing because Manaworm is extremely threatening just on its own. Like the chip damage that Manaworm can get every turn puts you within reasonable range.
Yeah.
No different than how Freeze Mage, the only way they can stay competitive against Warrior early on is through like Loot Hoarder damage early on. Or even Thanos, like
the Novice Engineer.
Yeah, you can't underestimate it.
So, if it chips away armor, then you're in a good spot.
Even if this is a very favorite matchup for Life Coach, he has to kind of take it seriously. But the one caveat is he has Brawl in the hand. So if his opponent plays on turn four the normal Water Elemental, then maybe he can actually justify keeping the Mana Worm on the board so it's one less minion that's Water Elemental.
Yeah, there's also a chance he'll just get Execute.
It's kind of close. Your opponent's playing so many cards that it just feels likely that he's going to hit a minion. He also kept Coin, too, and you know that your opponent has the ability to play Azure Drakes and keep up like the momentum, too. So it's not exactly an easy decision.
Uh-oh.
It's still far away. I think Water Elemental is awesome here. If there is no Brawl, there's no way to remove it. You can really lock down the weapon and have a big body on board.
Oh,
and
nice
that's
draw.
Execute, yeah.
Nice draw. Being able to average gold execute, nothing really challenges the 3-3. Then you can start playing Sylvanas with a board lead, even.
Still no Cthulhu plebs, but you're definitely happy about it.
Cthulhu plebs? I'm pretty sure they are very much subscribed to Cthulhu.
Yeah, for sure.
For like 36 months in a row.
For life.
They are disciples and followers, man. Yeah. They're anything but plebs.
Okay, well, this is one of the reasons why Temple Mage is pretty tough against this matchup, is because you don't know how far you can extend on the board.
That was awkward turns, right? You kind of want to have board to deal damage, but you don't, because there are brawls.
Yeah.
Yeah, I kind of don't mind saving coin either, just to kind of coin Ragnaros for pressure.
Yeah.
So if that's the case, he doesn't want to like Drake and leave up the 3-3, so he had to coin. That kind of leaves him awkward for the next turns. He has to play Drake and Arcane Missiles or Failing Arcane Missiles.
Drake here is fine. Just have a 4-4 on board. Oh, is he going for the missiles?
He's going for the Arcane
Blast. Yeah, sure.
I still don't know if I like using the coin that much. I feel like, I don't know.
I do like saving the coin. I mean, the 0-1... health taunts. How valuable are they, do you think?
Not that valuable. You also have to look at what's your win condition in this matchup. Are you going to win by like playing one thing a turn? Are you going to win by just like trying to outvalue? Mm-hmm. I don't think you are. I think you're going to win by sticking a big threat on the board that's not answered. And bringing out Rag a turn earlier means that your opponent is one turn less likely to have a piece of removal.
And that's pretty close, I think. But, I mean, the Astrodex sticking on board is also, like we said, very relevant.
Yeah.
I mean, are you inclined to play a second Astrodrake here? Or do you feel like you just want to remove this 5-5 and then kind of let Sylvanas steal a 1-0-1, which isn't that relevant, and then go from there?
You could try and be greedy and, like, Frostbolt and ping the Sylvanas to try and keep your Astrodrake alive and let him steal the 1-1. You know, in bad matchups, if you know they're bad matchups, you have to take risks.
I think I actually like attacking with Vazudrake into the 5-5 and then our Arcane Missiles. Give your opponent a 0-1 and then play Azurdrake.
Okay, so then now he has Mana Worm to fill out the curve. I like it. I mean, just let him steal what he steals.
Yeah.
The hope here is that Life Coach will just run out of cards. Because Jackie still has like a lot of cards.
He's not running out of cards for a while. I mean, Gorehowl is one of the highest value cards in the game.
It's awesome, yeah.
So he can rely on that as the game goes on. One of the awkward moments right now for Life Coach is that he doesn't have C'Thun buffed at 10 attack. So things like Ancient Shieldbearer aren't even relevant right now.
Did he play a C'Thun buffer early on? Yeah, he played a Chosen.
Right? No.
He didn't play a Chosen?
He played...
Not this game, I think.
I don't remember, but he did say in his interview that he likes, especially in this matchup, he likes playing Doomcaller. It's just
he didn't play anything.
Yeah, no buffs.
Like, on turn four, he just slammed.
Going crazy. That's it.
You saw C'Thun chosen the opening hand. That's
okay.
One.
You had one shot. It's fine, man.
One shot, one opportunity. This is everything I ever wanted. One moment.
One C'Thun's chosen.
One C'Thun's chosen. Mom spaghetti.
Agreed. Agreed, TJ. Agreed. So...
Azurdrake.
Jackie can kind of keep this Gorehowl away if he just protects his 0-1 taunt, and that might be enough fuel for him to start prodding and poking a little bit. I wouldn't mind a Flame Waker setup here.
Are you like Flame Waker, even though...
You like Drake?
I like Drake first, I think. I still want to kind of like bait out the Brawl, and Drake is more power on board. I'm not feeling confident playing all those spells without sorcerers, yet at least. And you can have a really good setup with sorcerers later.
Yeah, yeah. I kind of like Drake post Brawl because of what it does. Like, kind of sets up the momentum too. I guess what it does do way really nicely here is that it gives you spell power boost to things. Because if you just ping an attack phase, it does also feel like just a little bit too slow.
You're not putting any pressure.
Yeah.
And I don't know. Flame Waker plus even protect your 0-1 taunt for even another turn. Like,
right.
Frostbolt the face.
Yeah. And then
push damage, get more damage on the Mana Worm. He's going to do that anyway, but now he's wasting the damage on the Mana Worm. So, I don't know. This is like halfway in between. It's like the worst part of both plays.
You think it's the worst? Wow. So you're just saying this is a bad play?
I don't know. I just disagree.
When you say worst parts of both plays, that just usually implies that he did the worst thing possible.
Mm.
Do you think it was that
right?
Bad?
Oh, you're saying I'm saying it. Dang. Twisting my words.
Yeah. Wow, Dan.
You missed a calling and being a
Didn't know
a
you
lawyer.
Hated Jackie Chan's plays that much. Jeez.
You have a career as the future president of the United States.
Thank you. I'd vote for me.
I'm sure many of them would. So, Beckon Revival doesn't really change much, I think. I think that's the first activator still.
Well, it's the first buff, so it's something, right? Like, you just need one more.
I like your optimism.
I think you just get Jessicar online and you try and get Jackie Chan to play into a Brawl. The earlier you get Jessicar online, the smoother your transition to late game is going to be. And especially with Gorehowl, having tank up,
yeah,
you basically just negate the damage. So you're not really worried about the board right now, because as it is, it's not incredibly threatening.
I think it's especially good to play Jessicar now, because exactly you have this spot, and then from the future you will have the tank up available to you.
Yeah.
And Jessicar is something you have to deal with.
Yeah.
All right, what about one Flame Waker this turn?
No. We have to save them.
Think outside the box, Dan.
Think like you don't have the Flame Wakers. What would you do?
Then I would just play the spells, but the Flame Waker adds... Oh, he's adding both?
He's going
ham.
He's going in. All in on the damage.
I mean, he has Face of Summer to reload.
Maybe he wants a Brawl, so then he can play Rag on an empty board.
Yeah, but Brawl would have still come out if he just had one Flame Waker.
Well, that's one thing. Plus, he also got Face of Summoner, so now after the Brawl, he can actually refill the board in a way.
It is a lot of damage. Each Flame Waker adds plus 2 damage.
Yeah, already at 14.
Wow. It's not a joke. And the Gorehowl will have to force him to take more damage. Ooh, after he Brawls.
That's big.
But, I mean, he's got tank up. That hero power is so insane.
All right, it's a Flame Waker.
Takes the minimum amount of damage besides the mirror image. Pretty good.
You can easily kill it. Play one of the plebs, armor up. And Life Coach is stabilizing in a really nice fashion. Because next turn, even, he can just play Beconner and get 10 armor if he wants to. Obviously, he also has like shield block, armor up, tank up, whatever he pleases.
Yeah. Well, Slam Rag. Hope it doesn't hit the 2-3.
Well, you don't have enough mana, but so maybe Faces Summoner.
You have enough mana for Rag.
You can definitely play Rag.
Just Rag here. You can hit the 2-3. I think Summoner is better.
Yeah, potentially.
Summoner so, kind of gets absorbed by the Gorehowl, which I don't think you mind. It's 5 damage to your opponent.
And actually, Jungle Panther is really good here. It's more damage, and it can't be answered by removal. Like the Beckoner. I can't trade into the Jungle Panther. So that damage is getting in.
So why don't you freeze the face then so the Gorehowl can't attack?
Yeah, freeze the face makes sense as well. That's why I said like no mana, because I thought like Ragnaros can only go with Frostbolt. And he only had 9.
Yeah.
I really like Frostbolt. You guarantee that 5 damage hits twice.
Oh yeah, here we go.
Not, you don't guarantee it, but it essentially does. Unless he draws Shield Slam off the top.
And...
Oh.
That's a Shuber.
You already could gain 10 life anyways, so that draw is a little bit redundant. But Beckoner plus the Ancient Shield Bearer does gain you 10 with 9 on the board, so it kind of offsets it in a way.
Yeah, well, it's great because you get minions as well.
That's true.
I think I like trying to find removal here with Shield Block.
Yeah, Shield Block gains you 9 life because you're just hero power as well. That's also pretty reasonable. But you also have 2 Ancient Shield Bearers, and there's 6/6s
on
the board.
Yeah.
It's also somewhat resilient to Flame Strike in a way, because your the 6 health means that it just won't die to Flame Strike. So it can withstand and fight back against minion pressure.
Yeah. Well.
So you play a 3-2, Flame Strike, go face.
You don't deal with the 6/6 that way.
Yeah.
Okay. Well. Question, do you...
Oh,
okay,
my goodness.
I was about to ask you.
Whoa.
Is there a world...
Do you Yogg here? No.
Is there a world that you can Yogg if you just go all face and Yogg?
Slow down, Wacky Chan. Okay.
No, that's too much.
But why not, though?
I think Yogg is your win condition away. Like, you want to get Warrior as slow as possible and only then play Yogg, probably on empty board.
So it is relatively optimal for minions. 3 minions is pretty good. That means any like 3 damage AoE works with Power Shot, Explosive Shot.
Yeah.
It means that Cone of Cold is good. It means that you can still do like Cleave and Dark Bargain.
I think you want to get Avenging Wrath to face.
So okay.
You want clear board, get him as low as possible, and this is your only win condition. I would probably even play Ragnaros before that Yogg.
This is an absurd amount of life gain, though. I mean, he's got 20 life gain just in his hand.
And he's clearing the board now with the weapon swing.
Yeah. So
part of it, yeah.
I don't know. This Yogg is going to have to be muy bueno.
It has to draw cards, clear the board, and summon minions. Things like Ball of Spiders and Infest are like really powerful cards.
Yeah.
First, of course,
yeah, and
we see the goodness of Ragnaros, whether he giveth or taketh away.
It's going to meet a swift end by the Shield Slam, but it's going to do some damage first.
Kill the minion.
Not bad.
Something.
And to be honest, Life Coach is running out of resources. He does have life gain, but if Yogg is able to draw cards, present a threatening board.
Yeah, if Yogg goes for like Call of the Wild, it can be really well, really good for Jackie Chan.
Yeah.
I mean, Life Coach is not completely out of resources. I mean, I think he has more resources than Jackie.
Well, it depends.
I mean, Shield Block cycles, and then you Shield Slam Cthulhu's Chosen, remove the board. You're ahead on board.
Oh, and
he's got a 7-9. Like, Doomcaller doesn't have to just be played to revive C'Thun. You can just play as a 7-9.
As a body
and
board.
Nothing from Mage deals 9 damage.
I would say...
Except for, like, Forbidden Flame.
Dan, honestly, I agree with TJ. Whenever I look at Warrior having 2 cards in hand, I'm like, this guy is just out of resources.
And then 3 turns later, he has 50 armor.
Yeah, I don't know, though. I just feel like Warrior... Like,
Yeah, that's the moment.
Here we go.
Yogg.
Upgrade.
Got a weapon, that's something that deals damage.
Oh, no.
Only down Benton there.
Buff it? Oh, buff.
Uh-oh, wrong target.
It's a fireball draw, that's something.
Jackie, no!
That Pasha is on Yogg.
Face.
Oh, okay.
He hasn't even cast it.
Oh!
There we go, there we go.
That's good.
Okay. He also can play the Arcane Missiles, implying that he has prep or... Innervate.
Yeah. What is this panda? A 5-6 now? With a hat?
A 5-6. Wait, does the hat go back to Life Coach's hand?
Yes. I think so.
That's a really good question, because I don't know if it interacts the same way Blessing of Wisdom or Power of Glory does.
Yeah.
Because you played it, it comes back.
But, I mean, this just means that Jackie Chan's going to slam a Yogg again.
I kind of want to, like, see it real quick.
You want to check the
Explorer's hat, Death Rattle, add Explorer to your hand. That still doesn't answer my question.
Okay, so it goes to Yogg's hand. Okay, that makes sense. That's intuitive.
Yeah, because Yogg's the one who played it.
Yeah.
So, speaking of Yogg.
And out of Yogg.
He's just so stressed right now.
Round two.
That's the panda.
Dude, that panda is fearsome.
The panda's going to survive this?
Well, he did enter the Colosseum. He just came out.
Spellbender's okay. Battle Rage draws a card.
Bird trap. Oh, no.
Oh!
Got him! That's all he needed. Just to
poor panda. Save the pandas.
Dude, he's drawing so many cards, too, from this.
Yeah, that's not any.
Okay.
That's
it's still
now, Life Coach. Now Life Coach is running out of resources. That's completely fair to say.
Yeah. And Jackie Chan, the one thing, though, is once Yogg's played, that's it. Your deck is what your deck is.
Yeah. No more cheats.
I mean, if he plays the Antonitis, that is kind of another god card to play, so to speak. Antonitis can be sick against Warrior.
He doesn't have Antonitis, though.
I know.
Cut
it. Sanguine, maybe. Secret, by the way, is...
Bird Trap
and Spellbender.
Yeah.
Doesn't help too much against... Disciple of C'Thun.
Right. I mean, Gore Howl is single-handedly keeping the Warrior in the game. Another reason why I don't really think that he's running out of resources, Gore Howl is just so sick.
Yeah.
You just can't outvalue Gore Howl with 1 or 2 cards. Oh, you can Harrison, excuse me.
And C'Thun is actually at 16 at the moment, so life is a resource.
That's also scary. And you're not killing that Warrior anytime soon.
You're trying at least.
Oh, yeah, you'll definitely try.
All right, well, he's going to Flame Strike because he realized that there's not really going to be a better board to Flame Strike here. And he can sort of get it out for cheaper. I mean,
great draw.
That is...
By the way, Jackie has 2 cards remaining in his deck.
Oh, no.
That's running out of resources.
So he is working on 5 cards or less remaining in the game.
And the thing is, Sorcerer's Apprentice plus Ping, that just deals with the tank up. So this Water Elemental and that Sorcerer's Apprentice have to stick for the rest of the game.
And there's a Cult Sorcerer.
He's like missing a Mana Worm, too.
Yeah.
Okay, Face of Summoner.
That's still good.
Yeah, but he's got a double Fireball here.
Yeah, and hope that his opponent can't deal with it. But we know that there's a lot of draws in Life Coach's deck. He has 9 cards remaining. He could get Removal, he can get Second Brawl, he can get C'Thun.
A 16-16 C'Thun.
Are there any 3 drops that can provide infinite value?
In Jackie Chan's deck overall, or
what do you infinite value in what sense? Like any minion that sticks kind of hits infinitely, hypothetically.
Well, like that can
there is a dude that
produce
is,
more than what a normal 3 drop would.
But there is a dude that is at 2/5. When you hero power, you can actually get him back to hand. So infinitely, you can actually
the Colosseum manager.
Yeah.
I guess
that is infinite value.
I think you just want like Mukla or Interblade Master.
Congratulations, you sapped yourself.
Shadow Fiend is not it, and you're not going to even draw any card. You do have a bear trap, so if it comes out, you have the bear attacking it. It's a lot of power.
But the Water Elemental is going to go down.
Yeah, Water Elemental going down is a pretty big deal. Ravaging Ghoul, not exactly the most useful in this position. You're still also kind of afraid of the Hunter trap. It could be Freezing Trap. I don't think he's attacked yet with the minion. Everything's just been cleared.
Yeah, everything was cleared.
Yeah, so it's like one of those weird things where you kind of you definitely have to attack to go for it. If the Snake Trap, you can also Ravaging Ghoul afterwards.
Yeah. Oh, he's going for the Ghoul first?
Oh.
Well, he was attacking with the weapon, so he knows it's not Snake Trap.
Right. He knows it's not Snipe, knows it's not Mirror Entity.
So it's going to be Bird Trap.
He goes for the attack first, and I just think that this doesn't play around Snake Trap, but I think that's okay, all things considering, because he's just removing damage on the board.
And he doesn't care about the weapon attack at all. He actually just removes the highest power minion.
Right. And Jackie is just going to lose here. You can't beat Tank up. And that's going to wrap up the game. Cthune Warrior takes it. So Jackie's left with his Druid and his Warlock.
Yeah.
So this Warlock is quite peculiar. It's not a normal Warlock. It's a Dragon Warlock?
Yep. Something like that.
With Malagos? No Malagos?
We didn't see. But Dan knows the list, right? Zara's his Warlock. There's no Malagos in it.
Yeah, so it's like two ofs of everything. The only exception is like Alexstrasza and Emperor.
Yeah.
But you've got like two ofs of Peddler, Hellfire, every dragon, Sunwalkers, Imp Gang Boss, Siphon Souls, Soulfires. So yeah, Hellfires. What's up, Lothar? How you doing, buddy? You want a mic? No, thank you. You look way too sober, buddy. But I'm glad you're here. Makes me feel very nice and fuzzy inside.
Very unsober.
Yeah. For sure, like, the Warlock deck can definitely keep up with the Warrior because it pressures. One of the biggest counters to control in general is just, like, mid-range pressure. Think of, like, what Druid used to do back when Force Ninja Savage War was a thing. Or think about Midrange Hunter and what it does. And even Temple War to a certain extent. How it just kind of runs away with the board. I guess Dragon War is the closest thing right now to the midrange-y style.
Probably, yeah.
So,
You have to take it right now, I believe, because Druid has a bad matchup versus Cthune Warrior, and specifically, I think, Jackie's version, which is the Wisps of the Old Gods.
It's an interesting wheel in Hearthstone, because I know in a lot of card games, control's supposed to beat aggro. Aggro's supposed to beat like mid-range, right? And mid-range supposed to be control.
Aggro is supposed to beat control.
Or is that
control
the other way
beats
around?
Mid-range. Yeah, aggro beats control because aggro is too fast for control. Control beats mid-range.
Right, and mid-range, and mid-range beats aggro. Yeah. But it's kind of like the opposite way in Hearthstone in a way.
In Hearthstone, curved decks beat all.
Yeah. You curve go face and you win.
Yeah. That's kind of not true at
all. Not true. Plus, there's also combo as the fourth pillar.
I like you, TJ, but I think you've been hanging out with Chalky a little too much, man. Oh, Jesus.
Why did everybody think I'm so impressionable?
Yes, you are.
Chalky doesn't run my life. I run my life.
You're hanging out with the memers too much, man.
It's just Chalky is too influential, man.
I think I've hung out with Froden more than Chalky.
Probably.
Yeah.
I like hanging out with Chalky. He's really funny.
Yeah, Chalky's a great guy.
When he's not sleeping. Actually, Jackie might be even more fun to hang out when he's
not
sleeping.
Not even costing you $150.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Jackie goes for the Druid. And he gets Yogg and Onyxia in the starting hand, which is not good. But Innervate and Raven Idol is all right.
This is one of those situations where I think you need to find that wild growth. So this is one of the times where I'd say Raven Idol on one is pretty solid.
Yeah, I like it. But oh my god, Life Coach got both plebs to buff Cthune. So he will be able to activate that shield bearer. He can do anything.
Ooh, the restraint. The discipline. The self-control.
He's evolving.
By Jackie Chan.
Can we explain why, actually? Why do you not use Raven Idol to get the Wild Growth?
He doesn't know what he wants.
I mean,
he might pick minion.
That's bold.
Look, he doesn't have anything to play for six turns.
Yeah.
The seventh turn, he can innervate out the Onyxia.
Yeah.
I mean, of course, he will most likely pick up a thing to play. I wouldn't have hated Minion. Just putting it out there.
You can actually pick up a second Yogg-Saron. Spell is usually good.
Sometimes you get the minions against Warrior, but I don't think the on turn one or two.
Yeah. So the minions, there's actually a lot of great class minions for Druid. You can pick up
Raptor.
Ancient of War. You can pick up Druid of Call. Yeah, Raptor. Dark Hirokoa.
Ironbark Protector. Volcanic Lumberer. Cenarius.
There's
Aviana. Like, there's a lot of great dude. Fandral, Staghelm, number
even
two.
Ancient of Lore, which has been long forgotten, is actually pretty solid.
The fact that you can get a Raven, that you can get Fandral off of the Raven Idol.
Yeah, that's
it's just bananas.
Also, Deathwing is quite nice from a Raven Idol.
Yeah, sometimes.
I mean, while we're in that subject, you can get like any perfect minion for this perfect situation off Raven Idol.
Yeah. Yeah, Black Knight's great from Raven Idol.
That's why it's such a double-edged sword. Like, you always feel like you can win because you have Raven Idol, but you always... I don't know. It's so innocuous, too. One mana. It's like, yeah, I can always just pick the right answer, but it's not how it works.
Yeah, like, we talked about all those great minions, and then you Raven Idol. It's like Dark Peddler. You can pick Abusive Sergeant, a chicken, or a Wantu Pirate.
Yeah, Alarmabot.
I'm okay with passing here. Druid's been really passive, too. You definitely do not need a Disciple of K'Thun to face.
Yeah, there is no need. You will have still time to play
it
later.
I think what Life Coach is thinking is, what is my opponent doing now that he's Wrathing and passing? Turn 4 play, if he plays a minion, do I Disciple of K'Thun execute?
Yep.
Do I slam execute? I even just pass?
It's actually scary if you think about it. If Druid is not doing anything, if Druid is just passing, you think, hey, maybe he has like Innervate, Violet Teacher, or Fandral with some crazy things, and it's just going to be this one big blown-out turn. So how do I respond to that? But fortunately for Life Coach, Jackie Chan doesn't have anything.
Whoa!
Oh, he's going for it already?
Well, this would be a second K'Thun buffer, so it means Age of Shieldbearer is activated.
Yeah, in three turns.
Yeah, but also, if from Nimch's point, if Life Coach thinks that Jackie Chan is holding on to that crazy combo, having something on the board is actually pretty important. But I guess, yeah, I mean, if he to be able to play Slam and Execute next turn, then he doesn't want to have to spend the three mana on Disciple of K'Thun to get the two damage. He just wants the two damage to be there.
Okay.
But now that Jackie Chan doesn't play anything, decision doesn't make sense.
So you're saying that if you play Bio Teacher, Innervate Power of the Wild, the 2-1 can kill a 2-2, and you can slam execute a teacher.
Yeah.
Yeah, and execute
the... That's the way he's playing around. That is pretty next level, man.
Well, when you take your whole turn, you think through everything.
And if you were watching Jackie Chan over this weekend, like, you know how he draws. So you kind of expect the best.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Also, I don't mind, I dig it. I really like advanced plays, man. I think they're really fun to dissect and also fun to see if it works out or not. Because he just gave up two damage to the face with Disciple of K'Thun. He gave up another execute enabler, something that pairs well with things like Slam and Ravaging Ghoul.
Oh, baby.
Double Innervate.
Give us the Power of the Wild from Raven Idol.
Hmm. What about Onyxia?
Just force him to have Brawl right now.
Yeah.
But it plays right into turn 5.
I mean, if he's using Brawl on the Knicks, I don't know.
It's 3-for-1.
It's true.
Well, Brawl is one thing.
The 8-8
cool,
can survive.
Cool and Execute is the other thing.
Yeah, that's also pretty scary. So we have to try and think of Jackie's win conditions in this matchup when you have a slow start.
Overall, this matchup was really bad for Druid. So what you do, you try to bait out the first Brawl, then try to bait out the second Brawl, and then you got him.
Then you got him.
Yeah, after the second Brawl, you're like, sure, this is my board, and I'm going to rule it.
I think the matchup's closer than a lot of people say. Does Jackie Chan has Soul of Forest? Does
yeah.
he?
I think he does with Wisps. He has the Wisps version instead of the Ancient of War version.
Soul of the Forest, Life Coach said himself. It's really good against Warrior.
Like, what happens if you have a normal version without Soul of the Forest, if you run Savage Roar, Feral Rage, Mulch, you go to Fatigue almost, and you try to get some value from Yogg-Saron, and if you fail, Warrior just outvalues you with standard cards. And if Warrior is able to just keep the brawls also, it's really annoying for the Druid.
Yeah.
So you somehow need to play around, well, kind of get that brawl going on from Warrior, and also play around Ghoul, so that Ghoul, like, you want to force Warrior to play brawl instead of just ghouling your board.
Yeah.
There's another turn of disrupting his inevitable explosion onto the board. And because he doesn't have brawl, he's super afraid. He says if you want to have your turn, you have to at least give up 2 mana to do it. And your Azhadrig.
Which kind of feels like reckless a little bit. He's using Sylvanas to buy time, essentially.
I mean, here's the thing. His opponent is holding 8 cards. His opponent passed on turn 2, and he's using Wrath on turn 3. And it just feels like he's holding way too many cards. And the way that a lot of these turns end up happening is that Druid goes for an explosive turn all at once. They play Teacher, Roots, Raven Idol, like Power of the Wild. And all of a sudden, you're staring at a 4-6 with a lot of 2-2s, and then they Savage Druid out of the game.
Yeah,
Life Coach is trying to get way ahead because he's making the read on Jackie that says your hand has to be like a bunch of insane Teacher innervate combo stuff, which is kind of true.
Yeah.
Except he's like, because of the way that Life Coach is playing, is disrupting what Jackie's trying to do. Because Jackie probably would have gone off by now to some degree.
Yeah. Jackie basically prays to get the Soul of the Forest. That's why I'm actually surprised he didn't Raven Idol this turn. Because if you would get the Raven Idol, the next, well, from Raven Idol to Soul of the Forest, the next turn he can Wisp plus double innervate Soul.
Right. And that Berengan is a big-time draw. Now he has multiple AoE sources that can deal with Power of the Wild. And he has a big threat in itself that will dictate some Druid removal, so that way he'll have continuous threats lined up for his opponent.
This might be an Ixia turn, actually.
Everything that he has that he can do is vulnerable to a few things.
Yeah, I don't mind, like, Wizard of the Oak Gods. Well, maybe even like Teacher innervate Drake too. There's actually a lot of viable paths you can take here. He has 2 Wisps of the Old Gods, so even if Ravager Ghoul came out, it wouldn't be too bad.
Yeah.
I like Onyxia because Onyxia not only requires some kind of removal like Ghoul or Brawl, if there's only Ghoul, it also requires an Execute.
Yeah, but your opponent's also only a lot of cards. The nice thing about Ghoul Execute is that it takes away 4 mana of his turn, so he doesn't get to do anything else, really. Mr. Yeah. Hero Power. Uh-oh. Oskaka's back.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no. Oh, he's refusing the microphone.
Nah, this guy's just watching the screen. Cover your foreheads, guys. Cover your foreheads.
What?
Oh, it's actually Lothar there, yeah. Lothar was playing for a moment.
Oh, what the heck? Yeah, you're on the player cam. I just noticed that. That's like the longest it's taken me to notice you on camera.
That's how Oskaka showed up randomly.
Nothing is on the player cam, don't worry.
Don't worry, Lothar.
Don't worry, nothing to see here. Lothar just getting in front of the camera as usual.
You're winning 2-1, Lothar. Don't worry about it.
At least you're a self-aware attention whore, Lothar, as you mentioned. All right, to be fair, Lothar was the one who said it. I know I might not pick up on the mic. It might sound like I'm just calling him names, but he did say it himself. Let's see.
If you're your goal, you still have Geddon.
Yeah, Geddon's not too bad here, man.
And you have to play Geddon, because if not, you're good wrecked.
Yeah.
Jackie was just hoping for... He was hoping to get, like, a brawl or nothing. Because if nothing happens, he just Wisps again.
Right.
It's a great board.
Yeah, but, you know, I feel like this happens all the time when you play Wisps.
But now we have to deal with the 7-5 and then try...
You can get a spell off of Raven Idol, too. Yeah.
Why is he holding to this Raven Idol?
Well, he's waiting for the perfect opportunity, man.
I mean, to be fair, he had that from turn one. He didn't know what he wanted, and now he knows very clearly what he wants. It's a way to remove that Berengan.
All right, Violet Teacher and...
Raven Idol, maybe? Oh, it's just Azhadrig?
Azhadrig's out his swipe here.
Oh!
That's a nice swipe.
James Good.
Jackie, come on.
Wacky Chan does it again.
I like it. That's a good catchphrase. Okay, so Would you be willing to part ways with the Shield Slam so you can get a very clean 6-6 on the board?
It's not bad. And if you think about the targets you've dealt with on Ixia, which is the biggest target on board, and the deck,
yeah.
Well, I don't hate it. And just gain some life, get a 6-6. Is there anything better? Do you maybe just want to have... No, Doomcaller is probably better to...
I mean, Doomcaller's a 7-9. It kind of dictates your opponent to use Mulch before C'Thun comes out. I actually don't like... I don't hate that either. I don't know if you actually need two C'Thuns to close out this game. I think you just need one huge dude to stick.
One should be enough.
So Doomcaller Shield Slam actually also has a lot of credibility. It also even buffs C'Thun as a side thing, too, if you think about it. And C'Thun's already at a...
10-10?
10-10.
10-10, yeah.
That's very reasonable. I like it. Now that I really think about it.
So the biggest dude in the hand, almost the biggest guy, because there's
right.
This one comes down.
And Jackie doesn't even have Mulch. Oh, just kidding.
This is Jackie Chan. Hey,
that's kind of like even worse for Jackie, because it feels like now that he drew it off the top, it's like, yes, that's the answer I'm looking for, and he uses it immediately, and then C'Thun comes out. That actually might be the undoing.
He still has that Raven Idol, though.
That's true. You can also Raven Idol first off the Violet Teacher and get that extra 1-1 token.
Yeah.
So you can Violet Teacher, Raven Idol.
I don't know if Raven Idol is that good, unless Jackie Chan like wants to pick up a Soul of the Forest. If he wants to do something like Violet Teacher, Mulch, Raven Idol, then innervate into Soul of the Forest.
I would love to see Raven Idol here and try to get that Soul of the Forest as soon as possible.
Yeah, but I mean, how likely is Soul of the Forest to come from from Raven Idol? There's a lot of Druid spells, a lot of poor ones. There's always that Moonfire tucked in there.
Well, if you don't get it, you nourish.
Oh, interesting.
He decides to nourish first because of that Soul of the Forest. That's why he also holds the second Innervate. Oh, he's just going for the Innervate and Mulch right now.
All right.
I wasn't expecting a nourish there. I was kind of expecting the Raven Idol to pick up something else, but it's more reliable to get card draw sources, which, you know, interesting enough, gets a more card draw.
Yeah, I was thinking like he's trying to get the Soul of the Forest to be able to set up a board that's not being easily removed.
If this works, I mean, he's got a lot of heavy minions like the Twin Emperor, the Shield Bearer, Emperor Thorsan.
Yeah.
Also, now that he has Bran, if Life Coach can find a way to get Bran to stick on the board, that's also a way to lights out your opponent.
Yeah. C'Thun, I don't think, is an option this turn. It's only a 12-12, and there's 8 health on board.
Yeah, you can still buff it, so...
So, yeah, you can still buff it, and I don't know the math. I don't know. It's too late to do the math, but I feel like there's a likelihood that Violet Teacher sticks on the board, even if you play C'Thun.
But still, you've just seen Mulch.
Yeah.
So that's also tempting.
Yeah.
C'Thun is 12-12, all right?
All right, here we go.
C'Thun, then.
We'll see if he can take out the Violet Teacher.
Yes,
he does.
He did.
And this is why he held on to the Raven Idol. Not really, but a good thing he did.
Well, he also has Yogg-Saron, which is a possible answer.
Yeah. I don't think he's played enough spells yet.
Yeah, probably not.
Oh, it's definitely a Raven Idol thing. I don't know if I like the Battle of the Gods. That's what the name of the event is.
He's going for it.
But his button is green.
Oh, that's terrible.
I don't know. Wait, but he gave him a second C'Thun.
Oh, yeah, that's not good.
Yeah, that's terrible.
Wait. Nope, we still got a chance here.
Call of the Wild.
Okay.
Okay, not bad. Card draw is kind of trivial at this point. Doesn't need any more cards.
There's always card draw.
Oh, he was so close to neutering.
Vaporize.
Okay, Vaporize is actually really good against C'Thun.
Yeah. Well, I don't know.
All right.
Life Coach doesn't
all
have to play C'Thun here.
All things considering, that was okay of a turn.
Yeah, and Life Coach doesn't want to play C'Thun because what if it's Mirror Entity?
Yeah. You just play other minions, I guess. You can play the...
Bronze Shieldbearer.
I guess you could play the Armored Warhorse as well. No, I don't know. That's actually tricky.
What about Bronze Shieldbearer? You play Bran. You might give Bran to your opponent. Bran is...
Yeah. Bran's not that useful in Druid because they have so many choose one effects. It doesn't count as a battle cry.
Yeah.
Unless, actually, there is Mirror Entity and Yogg-Saron gets double spells.
Oh.
Nimsh. I like the way you're thinking right now.
Right?
Bravo, my
friend. That would be awesome.
You can play around it by playing you know, Onward Horde Horse and like Cthulhu's Chosen, that means no, there's no good trades whatsoever.
Yeah.
Like when the mirror entity comes. Of course, if Life Coach knew, he'd be able to benefit. Oh, he won the charge!
Nice!
Sick!
Well,
that's five to the dome, except...
Nope, that was a short-lived horse.
Well, I mean, actually, he's kind of relieved that he knows what Secret is. Now he knows it's not Counterspell.
No Ice Block.
Yeah.
Buffing gets on even more.
All right, so Jackie Chan's hand is actually not that good. He's got Yogg, but right. He's got, like, Nourish and Double Wild Growth with a full hand.
Hey, at least he knows Cthulhu is in the hand now.
Yeah.
So he can expect it.
Yeah, so I think you're just... I don't know, going all in here. You're just playing Raven Idol, your Mire Keepers, maybe even your Living Roots.
I don't understand why he's not playing this Raven Idol.
You can just Hero Power down the 4-2, and then... I mean, maybe he feels like it's a battle of attrition, so he needs Raven Idol off Fandral. It could be also another thing, too.
Like, yeah.
If you're just going to play Raven Idol anyways, which you know you will... You can save Raven Idol for Fandral and make sure you try to grind your opponent out of the game.
Oh my god, play this Raven Idol Swift Rage. Finally!
Alright, spell it is. And Moltres Naturalize. Oh, those are
misses.
I don't know if they're misses. Wrath?
That's not bad.
Yeah. Wrath can help him deal with what's on the board.
Okay.
Mark yeah, but the wild, though.
The problem is, though, there will be Cthulhu at some point, and you've used your Moltres from your deck. So you kind of wanted to have an answer to Cthulhu.
Yeah.
You have Yogg-Saron as your only answer now, or the second Raven Idol.
Okay. So he's trying to really punt, like put the board pressure off so that way he can use Wisps of the Old Gods and Savage Roar.
Or he's just trying to use the most possible spells he can use in a single turn. Because Wild Growth counts for two, so he really used, what, seven spells that turn?
One, two, three, four, five spells.
Raven Idol, Wild Growth is each two, so that's five.
It's in the Master's Tree Bar, I think.
Living Roots, and... Mark of the Wild.
Seven spells. And he was around seven spells with the Yogg-Saron, right?
Yeah.
So now he's around 14, which is kind of like a magical number. Like, you want to be, I think, from 10 to 15 with the Yogg-Saron to have a plausible effect.
I think in this matchup, you just want as many as possible. Nah, no, maybe not.
Wait, what?
Not really.
Are you sure? Like, seven spells? I thought it's five.
Wild Growth and excess mana.
Yeah.
So that's two. He used another Wild Growth. That's Wild Growth, excess mana. So that's four. He used Living Roots, Mark of the Wild, and...
No, he used only one Mire. One Mire Growth in his hand right now.
Yeah, actually, he just used
one
Mire
Growth. He used five spells.
Oh.
It's in the Master's Tree Bar.
I'm going crazy, man.
Yeah, no worries. It's kind of late, man.
He passed over the second Wild Growth.
Yogg-Saron is above 10 spells.
Yes.
Which is all right. You have to be careful. Like, if you have too many spells, you can actually overdraw.
Yeah, so five spells. My apologies. But now Cthulhu is huge. So this has to be Yogg.
Right.
It's got to be.
Well,
maybe not.
Well,
you need to clear the board.
Consider it.
You need to clear the board and protect yourself. So
it's another green end turn button implying can't do anything, can't attack, no minions on board. That's not the worst. He's drawing more cards. Kind of scary.
No,
not this minion.
That is bad. Oh, it's really bad.
He buffs the panda again. Like Yogg-Saron loves those pandas.
Okay, that's good. He actually kind of wants to remove and not burn. There you go. Oh, okay, safe. Safe.
But Cthulhu, what is Cthulhu right now? Cthulhu's huge.
Oh.
That's game. I think Cthulhu, what is Cthulhu? A 20-20?
18-18.
Oh, no.
18.
One
he
off.
Is one it's damage still, off lethal.
It's still really good.
Wait, Forsen's here. We don't even have to roleplay anymore.
Forsen is checking the Cthulhu, though. No,
he's too busy losing in poker.
All right.
No, he's actually up. Oh, good job, Forsen. What a baller. All right, Ancient Shieldbearer or Cthulhu itself?
If you go for Cthulhu, that's your last AoE card. And if Jackie develops the board and destroys Cthulhu,
right.
You will have trouble dealing with Wisps of the Old Gods.
It's interesting because if you play Cthulhu, it kind of makes like almost any weapon lethal because then you can just slam and shield slam and get past it and then weapon, like Fire War Axe it down. Because he's like down to one. But then Feral Rage gains the health. He has to also deal with Cthulhu itself too. It's like an 18-18. How do you deal with Cthulhu? That he's used Mulch and Yogg.
Yeah, exactly.
He does have another Raven Idol.
I kind of like the Cthulhu play, man.
Well, if you don't go for Cthulhu, what do you do? Like, just play Cthulhu's Chosen to have more minions on board?
Yeah, I like Ancient Cthulhu. Shieldbearer. I kind of like the Cthulhu. All
right, Cthulhu gets Jackie to one.
He's at one.
And Jackie has one Raven Knight on.
Aww.
And from this one, see, can he get this mulch or even a naturalize? Something to just not let him die.
No, he's
rage.
Dead.
No, you can still mulligan.
There's no taunt.
Or cycle the wild growth at all?
I don't think he has another one in his. This will make him overdraw.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I was thinking.
And you can't. Like, he used Innervate already, so.
Yeah.
He can't really.
I think Jackie's just kind of like drawing the rest of his cards out of
it. Oh, he just killed himself.
Oh, okay.
Stylish Sudoku.
So, Life Coach getting a nice advantage.
3-1 lead.
This is going so fast.
Match point.
Yeah, Yogg does not want Jackie Chan to win.
So is this the last deck for Jackie that does not have Yogg? Or do
I don't know. I'm kind of feeling
Paladin.
A Life Coach victory.
I know, he lost to Paladin.
Warlock.
Paladin.
Yeah. The Dragon Warlock.
Dude, how amazing is Life Coach? You know what Life Coach does? Can we just take a second to step back and break down exactly what Life Coach does? He goes on stream and has a folder that says tournament decks, opens it up on stream, shows his decks, tells people what ban strategy he's going to use, shows up to the tournament, gets to the finals, and is about to win the tournament. Do you understand how mind-blowing that is to somebody who, like me, who like worked tirelessly day and night to conceal what decks I'm playing?
Yeah, super secret.
So that way I have this information advantage.
Like, we were rooming together in Valencia. I had no idea what you were playing.
Yeah. And I'm really sorry, man. I kept that a total secret, too, because I really wanted to share with you, but I didn't want to, like...
I know you don't trust me.
And he's playing an unconventional lineup. He's not exactly playing, like, the Dragon Warrior. He's like, yeah, I'm going to play this. And he lets the entire world see. And... he's still playing well at 2 a.m.
He is tired a bit, but yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, he's also in the zone. I don't really see Life Coach make a mistake. Even you can make that, he coined Sylvanas. Oh, he paid Disciple to go to the face.
Like,
that all made so much logical sense.
He seems less stressed than he was playing versus Dice, actually.
This guy is a madman.
He's a machine.
There's one more machine behind us, by the way, guys. Mr. Yagut is joining us.
Mr. Yagut is also a ladder machine.
Yeah. But Captain Warrior in the final, that's impressive.
I don't think he heard you.
Oh.
But that's okay.
Did you hear me, Yagut? Hey, man. You're a ladder machine. There we go. Now you heard me.
There you go. All right. Warrior versus the Warlock. I do feel like your game plan as the Cthulhu Warrior doesn't change from matchup to matchup that much. You still look for the same early game plays. Maybe Fire War Axe isn't nearly as valuable considering that the only early game target is the Dark Peddler. So it's not nearly as crucial as it is against most other variants of Warlock.
Yeah, Life Coach got a decent hand here with the small dudes buffing Cthulhu.
I do think that having War Axe is important ultimately to remove some of those mid-game minions, but you can expect Warlock to tap or be relatively passive early on.
Also, how does this deck even play from Jackie? Because from here it looks like a Reno Lock, but it's a more Dragon-oriented deck.
Yeah, it's just like a mid-range deck, so you can imagine it to be kind of slow on the uptake. You know, no different than how Druid wants to kind of like ramp with Wild Growth. Warlock ramps with card draw, so that way things like Twilight Drake become more powerful. And then you have a more consistency of early games through Blackwing Corruptor going down.
Does it play Jiraxxus?
I don't believe so. I think you play Alexstrasza, so that way if your opponent ever gives you the ability to be aggressive on the board, Alexstrasza can go offensive. Also, if you play Emperor, things like Soulfires become 0, Alexstrasza becomes 8. You can combo them really really hard.
So Cthulhu Warrior should be well-suited to actually win versus this deck.
Hypothetically, yes, because it doesn't matter how much life you lose, you still have 20,000 armor.
Yeah, and practically Jackie Chan waited till the last match to take this. He was afraid to face this deck with the Warlock.
It is the most unreliable deck because while this deck does seem like pretty cool, like it's actually a very efficient list. It's got two Wolves of Everything except for the Legendaries. It's also just kind of like lacking true power, if it makes sense. It's like early game is too weak to keep up with how fast everything gets on board. Like even mid-range Shaman gets up fast on board. Even C'Thun Warrior gets fast on board.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But this deck kind of gets pretty slow on board, and its late game is like not nearly as powerful as the other late game decks. So
if it gets too far behind, the mid-sized minions that it drops are much less effective.
You're often stuck with like a hand of 4 to 6 mana plays, and you have like 7 or 8 mana, and you're behind. So
yeah.
It's a little bit awkward.
Doomcaller can be useful in this matchup. Double C'Thun seems great.
Yeah, that could be pretty good.
Is Knifeclutch playing Thorsten, by the way?
No, I don't think so. But Thorsten is actually an interesting inclusion in this deck. It's if you know there's going to be a lot of control, Thorsten's sort of a must, because especially if you're facing a lot of C'Thun mirrors, being able to Thorsten with Bran and Doomcaller in your hand is incredibly important, because that means you have a possible 3 C'Thuns, which makes sort of the C'Thun mirror an auto win if your opponent is also playing the same deck without Thorsten. So,
well, what you can also do is keep the coin and then Thorsten, Bran, and C'Thun, and do Bran, C'Thun in one turn.
Yeah, but usually having 3 C'Thuns is better than branding out 1 C'Thun. I don't know.
Yeah, like both plays are awesome. That's for sure.
Both plays are incredibly awesome, Nimsh.
Yeah, I think one of the keys will actually be Sylvanas in this matchup for the Warlock. If it continues to grind out, one of the ways you can answer C'Thun, in quotation marks, is Sylvanas.
Yeah.
Because you can take away their ability to Doomcaller. But I don't know. There's still a lot of threats in the C'Thun Warrior deck. Twin Emperor comes to mind. It matches up pretty well against Sunwalker. Like, Sunwalker doesn't... I mean, Sunwalker kind of holds their own, but, Warrior... It won't get past the Warrior threats.
Yeah.
The fact that it's a 6-6 also kind of makes everything a little bit awkward.
So what would be the game plan for Warlock? Just try to outvalue C'Thun Warrior? Because you have life tap and they don't. So they have a limited amount of draw.
Okay, that's a pretty good start. Azure Drake.
Now what do you Hellfire?
What's really awkward is you don't actually have... This is your only dragon. So maybe you're more inclined to keep it. Because... Okay, well, now you have Jomo. But before, think about it. It's like, one of the biggest things about dragon decks is you don't have the dragon synergies.
Yeah.
Life Tap's supposed to offset that because you draw a lot of cards. So would you be willing to part ways with it?
Yeah. And finds a clever play here, just healing his Twilight Drake back up with the Earthen Ring Farseer. I was kind of looking at the Hellfire there, because Hellfire is not really that great of a card in this matchup anyway. You damage your own Twilight Drake. But you get sort of one of the more dead cards out of your hand that would otherwise have a hard time finding a use.
I think you want to get on board faster and just pressure Warrior before he accumulates the cards.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
Would you slam your own Acolyte here to draw a card? You can follow up by Disciple of C'Thuning the 3-3. Save, whatever, like, say he removes it with Mortal Coil, you still have Gore Howl in the 4-7. This deck doesn't really play Defender Vargas. They just play a lot of minions and Sunwalker. I guess you are for your Sunwalker in the end, though, and that's where Slam gets value. Okay, so he chooses to Slam the 3-3 instead. A little bit more of a less greedy version to do it.
Go face.
Actually, I like this a lot because if the opponent plays Sunwalker, then he can't choose between Coil and Sunwalker, so... either you choose to develop the Sunwalker, kill the 1-3, then you can pop it and play Gore Howl. Or if your opponent plays Mortal Coil, you can definitely develop Gore Howl because you won't have a taunt minion, and then Gore Howl is like the 4-7. This is a brilliant play from Life Coach.
Yeah, really will play there.
Of course.
Gore Howl is going to be a key card in this matchup as well. I'm not sure if we've seen any Uzus or Harrison Jones from Jackie Chan, but if you want to fight for board and there's Gore Howl on the other side, you're going to lose.
Well, I don't think there's weapon removal from the Warlock.
No. I don't think Jackie Chan's run weapon removal on anything.
Especially if he bounce rogue, right?
Well, not only that, but I don't think his game plan was to necessarily have a specific ban that he was banning all tournament. His game plan was just to like go by feel and ban according to the matchup.
Right. Freeze Mage, Rogue. Yep. These are all problematic classes that you kind of adapt on the situation. You could even justify banning like... Warlock if you're Jackie, because you have like the Tempo Mage and the Druid and a bunch of like other stuff. So
I think weapon removal on Last Hero Standing is only when you're building your entire lineup around banning a specific deck that you know will be popular in the format. Like I don't know if it was the G2 guys, but they were. I can't remember who it was, but their plan was to leave Warrior up, which wasn't actually a popular strategy at the beginning of the tournament. And by leaving Warrior up, they put a few weapon removals in their decks just to offset their plan to not ban Warrior.
Yeah. Well, Nyman agreed that the Warlock was the most dangerous deck in the tournament.
Yeah, I don't disagree.
Yeah, well, I don't know. It didn't really do that well. You look at Tice and Life Coach, they didn't even have Warlock in their lineups.
You know what I want? I want a Bloodsail Corsair off of Dark Pillar. I'm kind of feeling it.
Ooh.
I feel like Jackie hasn't really been himself this series.
No.
And one way you can really put the dagger into the heart or into the weapon.
That is some good weapon removal right there.
Is,
if he gets it.
A Bloodsail Corsair. Give me it. Give me that.
Wow.
Got him. He picked that before I could even see it.
Yeah. Same. Whoops.
That is sick.
That's why you don't want weapon removal in your deck. You don't need it. You can get it. That was so
huge.
That's
not a PogChamp moment. I don't know what it is, dude. That was insane.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Dude, yeah. Life Coach is pissed.
That was not only super important because that weapon was great, but you would just lose the game,
man,
with the Gorhold online.
That was ridiculous.
Yeah.
Is that enough to just win the game?
Well, I mean, he's got some burn from hand, but his deck doesn't really run any finishers, it feels like.
You mean from Jackie?
Yeah, Jackie Chan.
Jackie's finishers are just like constant board pressure.
Yeah.
And having like a little bit of damage from hand through Soulfire and Hellfire.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's Ragnaros as well. And,
yeah, Ragnaros is also a legitimate burn too.
Oh yeah, Ragnaros could come out as early as next turn. So Life Coach gonna have to find a way to maneuver around this. The Ancient Shield Bearer is a big body, but with so many little minions on the board, you're worried about you getting traded up to. So you kind of want to whittle away the board before you play that big thing, I think.
Yeah, it seems like playing the 4-2. Yeah. Shield Bug would be a waste on the 4-4, I believe. That's some more damage.
Yep.
But you can have a really nice Ragnaros here. Just... trading the 4-2 with 1-2 and 2-2.
That felt like a really good brawl last turn as well, so you sort of tested for it a little bit. So now you can feel free to play this. Pushing damage, providing a threat.
Right.
And maybe that's why Life Coach didn't play the Ancient Shield Bearer last turn. Going into turn 8, he knows that one of the ways he loses is by an unchecked rag. This allows him to play Ancient Shield Bearer plus Shield Slam.
No, also, that's exactly what he's accounting for.
Yeah, exactly. Also, if he stalls long enough, he maybe can use Shield Bearer with Bran on turn 10, but here definitely Shield Bearer and the Shield Slam.
Yeah.
It's much better.
I mean, you just have to account for the opponent's strongest plays on the following turn. If you play Cthulhu Chosen, what do you want to do? Just place Rag on empty board. How do you answer that? Exactly this.
That's a really clean answer.
10 life. I still feel like the Blizzard dev team at one point was just like, what if we just made this card gain like 10 life? Everyone's like, ha! Yeah, let's put it in there.
Yeah.
And the balance team's like, yeah, it seems good.
Something like 10 life.
Hey, at least there is a condition, and you have to play
10
bad
life.
Minions.
Oh, my goodness.
And it's not the only card to do that.
Chibnip said there's a condition. You have to play a bunch of bad minions in order to activate the 10 life.
What? Disciple Cthulhu's not even that bad.
Yeah.
It's not the best.
Cthulhu's Chosen's not even that bad. It's actually somewhat comparable to a Pilot Shredder in a weird way. It's not exactly as good.
They
obviously
don't have taunts. So I'm like, all right, just play your minions, I'll go face.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, we'll get news out of the Power Overwhelming. Okay.
It seems like a resource battle. That's why this Gorhold is so important.
Yeah. So you really wanted to fit in the tap. I was thinking like Shadow Bolt plus Blackwing Corruptor, and you preserve your 2-2 and your 4-4.
Right.
But this allows you to fit in the tap and allows you to maybe use the Blackwing Corruptor for, like, get a little bit more value out of it because it would have been effectively deal 1 damage.
Yeah, well, I think Sylvanas can come down now. You've seen Power Overwhelming too, so that means both Peddler's cards have been used. Therefore, you're less likely for it to surprise you. Mm-hmm. I don't think there's ways for your opponent to like play their Sylvanas if they have it and steal it.
Yeah.
So I'm okay with Sylvanas here.
What about getting just a car
online. What about Shadow Flame? But not really. You can't really steal then.
This deck doesn't really run Shadow Flames, I think. It's definitely like two Hellfires. If it's a Shadow Flame, it's a one of, and it's definitely like a tech against Zoo and Druid and a few other like board flood decks.
Feels like you don't really want to kill your minions. Like, you don't really have any minions that are Shadow Flame fodder.
Yep.
Without Power Overwhelming, you don't really have any way to activate it, and your minions aren't like overly statted.
Yeah.
So then Sylvanas is fine. Armor up on top of it.
Yep. It's a close call, but another reason why I like it is because, one, your opponent can't just trade into it without giving you some value on Sylvanas, but also, like, you have your own way to, you know, trick your opponent with Barengeddon as a way to, like, surprise steals with Sylvanas. Some people are like, okay, well, I'll just maybe ignore Sylvanas and, like, let her do her thing, and then all of a sudden, like, Barengeddon comes in.
Yeah. Well, sometimes you can't even deal with it.
Yeah, well, Jackie Chan's got a pretty good clear here. Because of the spell power, he's able to, like, attack in with the Twilight Guardian, attack face with the Azure Drake and Hellfire.
Yeah.
And, like, slam a Sunwalker. So he pushes 8 damage and has an empty board with a Sunwalker.
Price
he's
damage.
Actually pretty close to lethal, too.
Is it? So 7 plus 8?
15 as opposed to 7, 19. It's, like,
yeah,
kind of close. And he has Blackwing Corruptor in hand, too. It's obviously not, like, a clear two-turn lethal, but...
Well, it's not really 7 plus 8.
Yeah, Hellfire, Sunwalker.
Because the first Hellfire kills the...
Oh, yeah, that's true. It'd be 7 plus 7.
Right, that's true. Good point, Nimsh.
Great call, Nimsh.
You can summon 2 Twin Emperors. I kind of like that. A lot.
Yeah.
His card is already borderline busted, and now you get to summon another one.
Triple Emperor. Vec'lor.
Yeah, triple Emperor Vec'lor.
But Hellfire Shadow Bolt, Shadow Bolt.
Is that lethal?
It's almost a full clear.
Oh, almost full clear.
You leave the Bran up with 2. Oh, wow, you leave the Bran up. That's dangerous. Is there a way you can get past it?
You can just Shadow Bolt Bran.
There is a C'Thun.
Oh, yeah, you can Shadow Bolt.
Play your 6-6. 6-6 goes well into everything else.
Yeah.
There's also validity to double Doomsayer and Shadow Bolt the Bran, just like Life Tap, because how else are you going to get value off the Doomsayers?
That's true.
You're always going to be building the board.
Yeah, kind of like that, actually, getting value out of the Doomsayers. Is that if the Doomsayers go off, you have free reign, effectively?
Yep.
Well, Hellfire is still really good here overall.
Yeah, you get to Shadow Bolt clear. Definitely have to take care of Bran.
Yeah.
What I don't like is that you give your opponent initiative, and you're stuck playing reactive, and your reactive cards are Siphon Soul. That's it. I mean, you have Blackwing Corruptor, too.
It's not really that you had a choice, actually. And it's still like you really need to remove the Bran because of the second Shulbert or C'Thun or whatever.
Yeah. I mean, there kind of is a choice, though.
I like Dance Play.
With, like, the Doomsayers, because...
Just double Doomsayer?
Because you're such a proactive deck. You create like so much minion pressure through the board that you leverage with Siphon Soul. Like, Siphon Soul gets way better when you have a minion to attack after you use it. Because then your opponents like play reactive, you attack, you remove that big threat. But when you're using it like defensively against a minion that shouldn't even be used against, like, it gets awkward.
Wait, so what was your play in total?
It was just Shadow Bolt the Bran and then double Doomsayer. So you're left with the Sunwalker with
Hellfire,
Divine...
No Hellfire.
No Hellfire.
Yeah.
And you leave the Sunwalker with Divine Shield up, and then your opponent has to get through the Sunwalker and then get through the 14 points of health from the Doomsayers, which is like nearly impossible.
Let's say like he also even gets through the Divine Shield, just like manually bashing through, and somehow like C'Thun clears everything. You still have like Hellfire and Siphon Soul to clear stuff. So it felt like a reliable way. And also... in this situation, Black and Corruptor helps you, but you're still, like, in the back of your mind, kind of afraid of just dying at, like, straight-up C'Thun. How big is a C'Thun now?
It's 12-12, I think.
12, and you 12. Have
you're
19
at 9.
Health.
What, if you draw a Doomcaller.
It's close. It's really close.
I mean, look at Life Coach's health. He's at 12. He does have Justicar, though, but...
Well, at least Life Coach has some good life gain with the Sun Cap.
Yeah, where Tank Up's insane in this position.
Yeah,
Jackie Chan only has Siphon Soul to heal himself.
I think Doomcaller is just like the better play, because if you play Barengeddon, it dies to the 5-2. And
well, if you play Geddon, you go up to 14, right? Because like it will deal 2 damage to you.
Yeah.
And there is 5 damage, so 9 damage kills you. Is there something that deals 9 damage that kills you?
It's interesting because Jackie hasn't played the Soulfires, and nor has he drawn it. It's starting to make me think that he doesn't have it in his deck, and he maybe just replaced it with other things.
It's possible.
But he's yet to draw into like his Imp Gang bosses. He's yet to draw his Alexstrasza, so he's got a lot of other cards that he could draw that don't exactly impact the board, just kind of...
Well, Alexstrasza will heal him and be an 8-8 on board, so that's quite
good.
Yeah,
but it's not like... Not like the Blackwing Corruptor effect, where it's just like a super swing, which you're always looking for.
Ooh.
It's not bad. Oh. I guess you could play that with Siphon Soul.
Yeah, Siphon Soul is 7-9. Kill that for free. Go 5 to face. You have a nice board. Warrior has only 2 cards.
That was reasonable. Like that or Imp Gang Boss. Even if he had Bran, consider playing it too. And all of a sudden... The charge from Jackie Chan, it's been a scrappy game. It hasn't been pretty at all. But, I mean, Life Coach is yet to get a brawl. He's kind of due for one.
Ooh!
Oh, Cthulhu, but...
16-16!
And, well, has a chance for lethal, hypothetically, right?
Yeah, even if you don't win, like, you maybe clear the board, you've just seen Siphon Soul.
There's 12 health on the board, though. How likely is that?
That's probably the best play anyway.
Yeah, there's no... Yeah. No Siphon Soul. You're likely to clear 2 minions. Not all 3, though.
There's a lot of multiple event probability going on with calculating this.
Yeah, it's like 57%.
You just have to go for
it. Gathun time. Those
just
minions
less
are...
base and more to the minions.
Oh!
Wow. After Doomcaller was already used. But, once again, there's not much initiative given to the Warlock and... The quality of minions in the warrior's hand is still pretty good. Barragan's like still really intimidating.
Nimps, do a card count on your so people
Warlock
at home can see.
So Warlock has 7 cards.
Okay.
Warrior has 10.
Warrior has
10.
10. Okay. Well.
Do you go Doomsayer to get initiative?
I think you can get away with Doomsayer and stagger it, actually. So all you can take, like, your initiative is like Chill Maul, and actually Chill Maul is... pretty strong.
But then if you play
Hal's dead.
If you play Doomsayer right now, opponent will just
double Doomsayer.
Double Doomsayer.
He doesn't want to tap.
This board
at all.
Is threatening.
And like, I don't think Life Coach is like that upset to pass either because
he doesn't mind. He's dunk up.
Yeah, like his opponent didn't play a really strong minion that didn't have an answer, so he gets another card in a way. There's almost nothing else to really think about. Your opponent also just kind of 2-for-1 himself in the name of tempo. And the card that he got with that play was Imp Gang Boss. Not bad.
Yeah, the question is like, how many frets Jackie Chan actually has in the deck?
Oh, right, Imp Gang Boss left.
Another Imp Gang Boss, that's Alexstrasza. Cthulhu chosen. Awkward to say the least. You could...
Oh, chosen is not bad.
You could Cthulhu chosen and... Barragan to kind of like remove the Imp Gang Boss.
But then your Disciple of Cthulhu dies. But you do challenge the Chill Maul.
Oh, you mean like Disciple and Geddon?
Yeah. I feel like that's one of the cleaner ways, and you just hope Barragan kind of trades with the 6-6.
What about Cthulhu's Chosen and Disciple of Cthulhu for 2 damage on the Chill Maul?
Yeah, I like it. And also tank up.
Okay, that's also fine too.
Because
actually, I like that a lot.
4-2 contests, both minions.
Yeah, I didn't think about playing the Cthulhu Chosen this turn because it felt clunky.
One thing's for sure is this one's probably going to come down to the wire. That all depends on what Jackie Chan's last cards are. He needs a big threat. He needs a dragon that's above average in size.
Yeah, I think he's played both Twilight Drake. So he's got like another Azure Drake, I think. He also hasn't hit his coils, which is interesting.
He's hit one
too.
Coil.
He's hit one coil?
Yeah, okay. One coil's there. And from Lifecoach's perspective, he just needs to remove every threat on board, and then he will win in fatigue.
Yeah. Tankup's not it's not trivial either. Oh, it's so bad. I think he has a tap now.
Yeah.
Tankup's not trivial either, considering that this game very realistically will go to fatigue.
That's not a dragon.
Lifecoach also, like we said, is yet to hit that brawl, which is huge if he's able to do it.
I think as soon as he hits that brawl...
Game's over.
Game's over.
Yeah, I don't know, man. There's still Alex Straza.
So now, can you get like a really nice Geddon?
You can. I mean, Geddon's going to remove the Divine Shield from the Sunwalker. It's going to leave a 1-1 up from the Imp Game boss.
Can he go for Ghoul Geddon this turn?
That'd be the same outcome almost.
Yeah, you kind of trade for the board. Actually,
You will kill Sunwalker, but you don't kill the Shilmodan.
You know, if Jackie gets Bran Blackwing Corruptor off, though, that's pretty amazing.
Well, he's got 2 draws to do it. I mean, he's got an Azure Drake left, as we mentioned. So.
Okay. No dragon pops in his hand, so he kind of gets a lot of information.
Yeah, I guess like you had to do it, because if there is a dragon and there's AoE, you'll be pretty happy about it.
Running out of time, though. Baron Geddon clears off the Imp King boss in the 1-1, but also clears off his Divine Chosen.
It damages you yourself.
What happens if you don't play the 4-2? It kind of encourages the 2-2 to trade into it, making Baron Geddon even stronger.
So go weapon, no Geddon. Armor up.
Maybe attack and armor up. Or tank up.
I think you can wait. Try to kill it.
Yeah, that's
turn.
True. You can always attack it next turn and use the Baron Geddon as well.
That's not a dragon.
Does he want to tap again? No, I don't know. Blackwing Corruptor not coming down for its battle cry value is pretty weak, all things considering.
Also, Lifecoach is slowly escaping the range. Like, look at the health pool at 17.
Yeah, exactly, man. The tank up's not irrelevant. It's actually his best asset right now, all things considering. It gives him so much mileage off of stalling his opponent.
That play from Lifecoach is actually really intelligent because he sets up for almost a perfect Geddon next turn.
Oh, man. So Alex Straws is one of his 2 last cards here, and I think that's his last dragon. So if he coils, or it could be the Azure Drake. I am kind of missing a card here. Maybe he has 1 Soulfire too in the deck.
Are you sure he has Alex Straza?
Yeah.
All right.
So I think it's positive. Azure Drake, Alex Straza.
Okay.
But Azure Drake is almost unplayable.
Yeah, it's pretty much. Well, not almost. You might be able
Alex
to kill
Straza.
Him before your opponent.
Yeah, well, it's a dragon.
Yeah.
There's Alex Straza.
Alex, it is. So now you can finally do.
He wants the Bran.
Okay.
Oh, the Bran.
He wants the 6 damage to face.
Oh, Bran as well. So if there is a roll, Execute does nothing, actually.
Yeah.
Wait, so are you dead? So you can go to, you're at 12, 13, 17, and the damage on the board is 8, 9, plus 6. 15 to off.
If he attacks face.
If he plays Geddon, he's dead, right? No, he's not.
No, he's not dead.
No,
if
he's
he attacks the 4 or 5 and
he's dead.
Tanks up.
Yeah.
So he's going to go back up to 13.
11.
Oh, yeah, 11 after the Baron Geddon.
Yep. And then that means there's 5 on the board plus the 6.
That's
Jackie
it.
Found exact lethal.
Oh, man.
Wow. Dude, what a close game. Holy crap.
Super close.
Are you serious?
Wow.
And the warrior falls down. This means Jackie is 3-2 versus Lifecoach. Still alive in this final.
That was super impressive.
Yeah, wow.
That was intense.
Can Wacky Chan take it all the way?
Like win versus what's left for Lifecoach?
Rogue?
So.
Oh, no, he banned Rogue.
No, he banned Rogue.
So mid-range Shaman.
There's Hunter
still. Hunter.
Shaman can be tricky.
You have double Hellfire.
Shaman's tricky because you give him the early game. And if you don't draw Hellfire, which you have the same thing as like having Brawl.
Double Doomsayer,
boys. There's a couple of ways
know.
To stop
I
it.
I don't know Doomsayer. I mean, Doomsayer can stop it for sure, but it also sometimes doesn't do anything.
Maybe this Warlock was built to stop the Shaman.
Well, usually a fifth deck is built to sort of make up for the weakness of your other 4 decks and usually like trade 1 for 1. So I'm trying to figure out what Jackie Chan was trying to counter with the Warlock.
Well, I'm thinking Shaman, he can actually counter Shaman with this, I think. If he gets the Doomsayers, if he gets the... Like Dragon Warrior is all right versus Shaman.
Yeah. I don't know. It's really tough. This deck is just new. I mean, it doesn't... I haven't seen enough of it yet to figure out what matchups it's good in.
it's like a mixture of Freenode.
Oh, Hunter. Oh, man, I forgot about Hunter.
Yeah, Hunter is there
as
well.
This matchup is so hard for the Warlock to win because you're life tapping naturally a lot. You're conceding the early board, except you have less AoE to control the board.
Yeah.
And you have more minions that get out-tempoed by Deadly Shot or a few other things, too.
You have no one drops.
You have no one drop, so Death Desert Camel is amazing. This is Life Coach's hard counter. But if Jackie can withstand it, and Doomseer is part of that equation, it might be going to game 7.
Well, Doomseer will stop the early game, but Hunter shines in mid game. So this is where this game is going to.
Indra Kovalder's not what you want to draw of your life coach. Doesn't have a turn 2 play either, but his 3-4-5 is looking pretty.
Yeah.
It's just that you don't have Reno, you don't have Healbot. Your best source of heals are usually by 3 or Alistros at 15.
Oh, it's Siphon Soul.
Right, your increments of 3 is usually the case. And I mean, I've played this deck and I've played a fair amount, and I feel like a lot of times Hunter is just the hardest matchup.
Well, Hunter is really good versus Reno Lock as well, so.
Right, that hero power is just so imposing. And here's like an interesting plot twist: if you like coin Doomsayer to stop the building pressure, Life Coach is not doing anything interesting anymore.
He's happy. He was just gonna hero power anyway.
Good steady shot.
But will Jackie Chan make that read? He's thinking, okay, if I don't Doomsayer and Life Coach has a 2-drop, he's got 5 damage on board.
Yeah, you're not landing.
It's likely that he'll be able to deal with the Doomsayer next turn, but he passes the discipline.
And that's not a 2-drop for Life Coach, which means steady shot to the face. Is he going to bluff that he has something to play, but he's like, oh, no, I will not play that huge toad this turn.
I think he was going to rope anyway. It acts as a bluff.
That's going to be the slowest Hunter game ever.
Jackie not playing Doomsayer implies that he really feels like he can save the coin, or he's putting the read that Life Coach doesn't have anything on turn 2. And that frees him to play Doomsayer this turn. What does the coin give him availability? He can coin out the Twilight Drake.
Well, in the Dragon decks, overall, coin is pretty good for Graptor or like a 4-drop on turn 3. Yeah. There's a lot of stuff you can use the coin on.
Well, Jackie Chan's going to need to take full control of the board and then some by turn 8.
I kind of feel that Jackie's going to be in the lead for quite some time here. Just look at Life Coach's hand post this turn. Like, you can't play Animal Companion reliably. Jackie's going to have the Twilight Drake on board.
Yeah.
Or even Bran, if he feels that comfortable, because his opponent's on turn 4, he knows his opponent doesn't have access to Kodo, so he can get like Twilight Drake and Dark Peddlers in the future turns.
That's actually not bad, because
double Dark Peddler.
A pretty safe Bran turn.
Or normally what you do on 4, you just play Infested Wolf, or even if there's a weapon doesn't kill Bran. So the only thing that kills Bran is what, like Deadly Shot? But then Deadly Shot using Bran, you're like, sure, I would just play my
Huffer is one way.
I don't think Life Coach's deck runs Festival, because it runs the extra 1-drops, and it also runs Double Houndmaster. I don't think you have room for Festival. But Bran Bronzebeard it is. Oh, nope.
Nope.
Twilight Drake it is. I was looking at Bran Bronzebeard, staring at it in the hand.
Okay, so Life Coach obviously has his hand saying, play the late game, you'll be okay. And, you know, if he's able to roll Huffer, or if he's able to maximize his hero power, I mean, Warlock's already kind of doing him a favor by getting so low to 22 because he life tapped.
Yeah, Huffer face would be great.
It's the worst option for Life Coach.
But it was like Animal Companion was the play this turn anyway, because on turn 5 you play Tiger, on turn 6 you buff the Tiger, go face.
Tiger's so scary. That's 9 damage coming turn 6, and that means you're kind of working on 13 health from that point on.
Finley.
Would you consider Finley? Because your hero power, after a certain threshold, like your hero power is great early on, but after a certain point, you kind of need like heal?
Yeah, or armor up.
Armor up, or priest is probably better, because you can always heal your minions too in the pinch.
Well, you also have the draw with Dark Peddler in your hand and Bran that can provide you some cards as the small combo.
I don't know, though. You're basically telling your opponent that my cards, on average, are better than yours.
Well, if you're telling your opponent my cards are good, I think that's fine.
Yeah, I guess so. Oh,
yeah, I like it.
He's thinking creatively right now just about how the implications of Finley. Ooh, Flame Imp's absolute no-no. Can't lower your health any further down.
Inside the mind of Wacky Chan.
Okay.
Sir Finley Murgleton.
That's a nice Tiger.
Tiger will certainly come down. Turn 5 is Blackwing Corrupted turn. You're looking at 8 power on the board. It's 11 damage to you. You're still not, like, under the world's most heavy pressure.
Oh, Life Coach definitely needs to think about this turn, but if you go... I think you just need to commit to the phase strategy at some point, especially because you are at 30, and your opponent will really want to trade into your minions and protect himself. So you want to dodge the Twilight Guardian, you want to dodge Chill Maw. Speaking about the devil.
Okay,
he's looking to Finley now.
Yeah, I mean, he has Twilight Guardian, which is the obvious play, but it's a question if he wants to play Finley now or later. And I don't think you lose too much by playing it later, because you don't necessarily need to hero power for a while, and you don't know if you need an extra card.
Well, that's...
right now, playing Finley is purely for the 1-3 on board.
Yeah,
that plays more into Unleash the Hound.
You can look at Jackie Chan's face. He's trying to convince himself that Sir Finley is not the right play.
Yeah,
His first instinct was Finley, and you can tell his internal struggle right now.
There's a realistic chance you play like Siphon Soul next turn.
And then Chill Maw possibly.
And then Chill Maw. So you're not going to hero power for a while, and you still might need access to that hero power.
So the question
to refill your hand.
Do you want the 1-3 on board? Because 1-3 on board will also help you to deal damage and fear things.
It does play into Unleash, though, and you're giving your opponent 5/1/1s. And if he plays like Unleash Kill Command.
He knows that Life Coach doesn't play Unleash, though.
Oh, okay.
He has to at this point.
Yeah, with the camels.
Yeah.
Camel build normally doesn't run on leash.
It's too many 3-drops. Kill commands, animal companions, desert camels, eagle horn bows. 10 3-drops in a deck is a lot if you run on leash.
Houndmaster is like surprisingly not that impressive because the 4-4 trades into the 5-4 or 7-4 afterwards. So, I mean, you can quick shot too. I think you want to maximize your hero power as well. There's a case for Animal Companion Desert Camel because it also builds up the board reasonably. You're both just as vulnerable to Hellfire on both sides.
If you get Leok.
If you get Leok, awesome. It's trades. But then if you get Huffer, it's like kind of a weird pivot strategy. You like quick shot the 3-6 and then you Huffer the 4-4 or something like that.
So what do you do on turn 7 though as well?
Turn 7, you can Houndmaster and something else. I don't know.
Yeah, Houndmaster kill Steady Shot to use our hero power. Or is he going for quick shot? Really? Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it protects his 4-3 because he's anticipating the 4-4 to go in.
Another Guardian.
I mean, this is like a case of whether or not you want to justify using Hellfire here. Probably not.
Well, trade Guardian Life Tap first, maybe. This will be the last Life Tap you do, probably.
No, I don't mind a Life Tap here.
Deal damage to face.
Twilight Drake, not the most useful here. And the fact that this is a 4-3 and it's a 6 of health minion is actually very relevant. Life Coach can't get past it very easily.
Yeah.
Oh, Bow's not bad. Bow's actually a pretty big draw. Oh
yeah, Bow is great.
I didn't think about it.
Now we can get, you can play either Animal Companion or Camel. Camel will actually extend the board.
Camel is probably more reliable. It gets 2 minions on board, so
yeah.
Call of the Wild is stronger.
Especially because you do not expect a 1-drop from Warlock. Mm-hmm.
Huffer is also a really bad liability as soon as you roll a Huffer on the 2-2 on the board.
I think these Call of the Wilds are just going to end the game.
Maybe.
Yeah, probably.
They definitely feel like they can.
They're looming.
Yeah, I mean,
Chill Maw could be an effective way to stop that.
Yeah, Chill Maw is really annoying.
Yeah, but it only deals 3 damage, so Leok and Misha survives.
They have Hellfire to follow it up. If you're Jackie Chan, you probably feel comfortable because you're expecting one Call of the Wild, but probably not expecting both.
All right, so Life Coach decides to kill the 3-6 with the weapon and the 4-3.
Okay, no Indra Kavaldir, which is the dream, but Fiery Bat, still kind of like okay. Ooh.
Can you play Chill Maw into this? Chill Maw does not die to the 2-4 and the 3-1 weapon.
Maybe he feels up for like Brain and Twilight Drake. No, that gives up his dragons. He needs a dragon. Oh, that's so awkward. You kind of need, like, Twilight Drake.
Yeah.
To be on the board.
It helps Chumo. So Twilight Drake wasn't that bad, actually, when he got it.
I don't know if I'm feeling Doomsayer, because nothing else really pairs well with it. You're not going to, like, life tap. So if you play Doomsayer, you might just play, like, Finley this turn so you can get, like, a different hero power to do stuff.
Chilmo is awkward in a way, because if you play Chilmo, if there's Call of the Wild, which you kind of expect, Huffer and Weapon Attack kills Chilmo, right. And then three minions survive. So you will be forced to Hellfire next turn. So that's probably better to have bigger minions.
I mean, the 4/13 is probably not going to die for a while unless your opponent has Deadly Shot. And if he's Deadly Shotting, it also means he's not playing Call of the Wild.
That is a Deadly Shot.
Okay, how good is the Call of the Wild here? It's pretty nuts. You get 6 damage plus the 5, so 11, 14 damage.
Oh, man.
You get 14 damage to the face.
Well, there is still some merit for Deadly Shot 4/13 and Animal Companion Hero Power. Because you're not really losing the combo.
That's extremely relevant, too. And even if the 2-1, the Fiery Bat lands on the brand, that's even more clean than it was before. It's pretty hard not to justify and Call the Wild when two minions are already on board. But, I mean,
I don't know.
What, you'd rather have the Call of the Wild?
You like
right
Call
now?
Of the Wild?
Yeah.
I think I like Deadly Shot more.
Okay, 2-1 should go into the 2-2. If it lands on the brand,
this is gonna be so clean.
We're in good business.
Yeah, even if it doesn't, it's fine. Oh.
Okay.
Doesn't matter.
It just bumps.
Much.
It just means he's more susceptible to removal on that, but it's okay.
Yeah, that's a really good board to have.
Yeah. And think about it too, TJ. His minions are stronger for another Call of the Wild the following turn.
That's true. And he fits into hero power, which means that Call of the Wild on 9. And then Call Wild on 10, he'll be able to fit a hero power in on 10.
Which means 7 damage, half for 5, and
still shot. So this is more efficient over the course of two turns. It might make Jackie Chan think that there's no Call of the Wild, which might make him play a little bit differently.
And by the way, there is no dragon in hand other than Chilmo, so Chilmo does not explode when dying.
Ooh, this gets some free development of the Call of the Wild. I'm not sure about this. This ends up giving full control to the Hunter over the board. And Hellfire is not going to clean it up.
And we've seen all 30 cards. There's no Twisting Nether. There's no Doom.
Oh, no. Jackie kind of not really feeling himself right now. He's just kind of unsettled.
That's a dragon. So Chilmo now works.
Yeah. Or Azure Drake Hellfire.
Oh, Azure Drake Hellfire is pretty big. But the second Call of the Wild, dude.
Maybe he Chilmo's first and then Azure Drake Hellfires.
Oh, it doesn't even trade onto the board very well because you trade Huffer into 3-2, and then you Call the Wild again. I mean, we know the second Call the Wild, but even then, there's 7 power existing on the board.
Oh,
18
that's
life.
Deals with some part of this board, but you get Huffer for 6. 9 damage plus hero power means 11 damage this turn. He is down to 7, and then he possibly dies to the Kill Command Hero Power.
Well, Jackie Chan has almost no healing in the deck as well. He's got Alexstrasza, which is sort of healing, but it's really expensive. He's got both of his Earthring Farseers left. So I just don't see, if Life Coach pushes face damage here, how...
Well, even if he trades.
He's still got to trade.
Life Coach is also at 10. Can Jackie Chan maybe find a way to go through?
Nah. He's counting. 1 Hellfire being used. He didn't see any burn like Soul Fire. He saw Peddlers. He didn't see 1 Peddler card.
Second Siphon Soul maybe?
He didn't see both of them.
He didn't see both?
Power Overwhelming is also from the...
No, you haven't seen Finley.
Yeah.
Yeah, Finley. He didn't see either Peddler card.
Oh, okay.
So if it's a Shadow Bolt and Power Overwhelming Abusive Sergeant or something like that, you'd lose. Even the Steltus board was Power Overwhelming.
He's got Lethal next turn anyway. He's got Kill Command.
And Bow and Hero Power.
That's 10 as long as one beast survives. Whoa.
That's brave. And that's a Shadow Bolt, which means can't find Lethal with Finley.
Finley can give him a Hero Power.
No way.
If that's a shapeshift of Fire Blast, that will be it. And that's a shapeshift. Steady Shot.
We're going to game 7.
Yeah, he goes for it.
Oh, no.
No way.
Oh, my goodness. 10 health is too little. And we have a tie. It's 3-3.
Jackie's getting up out of his seat.
Yeah, Jackie is going to have a toilet break, but...
Wow.
That is incredible.
Life Coach has to be kicking himself after that one.
He really forgot about the Dark Peddler stuff, man.
That's one of those situations where the only way you lose is if you don't trade.
No, he's playing around cards in the deck. He's not playing around the cards that are not in the deck.
Well, like what Dark cards Peddler. Was he playing around in the deck?
Chilmo.
Like if your opponent has...
Alexstrasza.
Of Shadow Bolt and Hellfire.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, if he the most damage he can do is Shadow Bolt, Hellfire, and he doesn't have enough for Blackwing Corruptor. Like, he had to choose between that. So he's playing around, like, the fact that his opponent can't remove the Misha and kill him. What he's not playing around is specifically Dark Peddler cards. Now, it doesn't have to just be Finley. It could be any Charger that, like, Sotas bore. It could just be a Soulfire. But what a way to go, man.
I just want to go back to the Finley pick, man.
That's extra damage, and that paid off.
So it was either Sir Finley...
Blood Imp or Worgen Infiltrator. Worgen Infiltrator is kind of cool because it gives you sort of like a free trade onto something. It gives you that free 2 damage.
Yeah.
Which is pretty enticing of a pick. But I guess the flexibility of Sir Finley, knowing that Life Tap at a certain point becomes... kind of too risky to keep going for.
You just can't use it at some point.
Yeah, and just the flexibility that it provides. And the other things, Jackie Chan, there was a couple situations where he had some pretty decent trades on the board, but he decided to push face damage instead. Life Coach just sort of got low, and it sort of just crept up on him over the course of the game. And, you know, finally at the last moment, it looked like he had full control over the game. And
yeah, I think I have to go back to also, like, little subtle clues. So, for example, there's this one time where Jackie floated 1 mana and he waited for, like, 20 seconds before ending his turn after he played his Twilight Guardian.
Yeah.
And if Life Coach kind of pays attention, Jackie may or may not have hovered over that 1 mana card, implying it's a Dark Peddler card. And the longer you hold on to a Dark Peddler card, the more situational it feels. If you have a 1 mana minion that just kind of fills out the curve, he probably could have used it at certain points versus if he's holding it. Well, and it's tricky. And here's the sick thing, too. Both Dark Peddler cards have to generate damage. So even if one of them was Powerful Woman, let's say hypothetically Life Coach was playing around Dark Peddler.
Yeah.
He played around 1 Dark Peddler card, but he's saying you have to have damage with both of them, which is completely fair.
And if he did make the read, the board situation for the player you're talking about where he floated 1 mana, there was no room for a spell. So he could rule out, if he was really paying attention, that the second Dark Peddler was a spell. So maybe he was thinking it was some kind of minion that is situational but also can be played, like a Stone Test Boar or an Elven Archer.
Maybe Corruption even.
Or no, because there was no minion on the board, and he did float that man. I don't know. It's a lot of like predictions and
really,
reads
really
and mind
hard,
games.
Yeah, it's really hard to predict that specifically with Shadow Bolt on top of it, because you're at 10 health, there's 5 damage on the board, there is a 4/4 taunt. So even if you think about Power Overwhelming and Soulfire, that's like so... PO on the minions so far into the Misha, and there's still only 10 damage.
Yeah.
So you feel like I will be alive at 1 in the worst case scenario.
Yeah.
But apparently the worst case scenario was you're dead.
Yeah. So now all of a sudden Jackie Chan has all the confidence in the world. You know, he was down 3-1. Now he has to be elated that he's actually even made it to game number 7. He beat the worst matchup for his deck. And now he's going into a matchup that,
dude,
I can't help but feel is much better than Hunter, at the very least, and maybe even good for Jackie Chan. He's got a good early hand with minions to play and a Hellfire, which can deal with mid-range Shaman not as much, but it does deal with those pesky 3 health minions. It deals with Feral Spirits, deals with Tunnel Trog.
Yeah, yeah, Hellfire is all the good stuff as well, like even the Shadow Bolt, right? But I'm just speechless because Jackie Chan, a deck builder, a guy who... designed the Camel Hunter, a guy who had many other decks, and in his off paladin is in the final right now facing Life Coach with this weird Warlock brew.
Yeah.
What is this deck? Why is this deck in the final? What are we watching, TJ?
I don't know, man. I don't know. This tournament has shattered all of my expectations.
And it's awesome. It's really great Hearthstone, and it all comes down to this one game, Jackie Chan versus Life Coach.
Yeah.
Dragon midrange Warlock versus midrange Shaman.
Yep, midrange deck just the way Blizzard wanted Hearthstone to be. At least, that's not true. That's kind of
good old
statement.
Board trading.
Board trading is fun.
Like in the good old days.
So this matchup, will be dictated whether or not Jacken can get on board efficiently, because Shaman always tends to get on the board pretty fast. Already introduced with a pretty big crossroads for Life Coach if he chooses to go for Totem Golem early, but then sabotage the rest of his curve. And as such, it just might lead him to hero power because of how many 3-mana plays he has in his hand.
But then Life Coach's brain looks like it's on fire.
Well, it surely is, because this is a really difficult turn. Like, if you go for the 3-4, you get the board, but then you only have Totem up. And if you just Totem up here, if your opponent coins up a free drop, then you're behind and you play catch up. But they both have clears. I think Jackie Chan has actually a better hand overall with the Hellfire and double Imgangbas. He can coin up the Imgangbas in turn 2, Imgangbas in turn 3. If something goes wrong, he has Hellfire. And he already has like a nice dragon as well. Not to mention Shadow Bolt that can deal with the 3-4. And Life Coach, yeah, like, just Totem Golem, how do you go for it?
I think you got a hero power. Totem Golem disrupts too much of what happens. And, you know, you can still play Totem Golem later on, which won't sabotage too much, but, you know, it's... Tusk Rush Totemic's too valuable. Yeah, these other things are just, like, way too good to pass up.
Shadow Bolts, by the way. Arena deck.
Oh, that actually makes it pretty easy, then, because now you can play Tunnel Trog and Totem Golem and still have 3 mana the next turn. There's no way you can avoid Imgang Boss from collecting value on you.
Yeah, that's probably it. And the next turn, if Chalk survives, you can Feral Spirit or Tusker Totemic. Like,
one of them should end up surviving. It's kind of hard for your opponent to remove everything from Totem Golem and Tunnel Trog.
Yeah.
And both of them have a lot of upside because, you know, the Totem Golem's like sick, and then Tunnel Trog, of course, can grow through the overload.
Well, for Jackie, he'll be able to Shadow Bolt 3-4 and kill the Totem, leaving the Trog alive. But then Life Coach will have options.
And then Trog gets actually a +2 buff, gets the easy snipe, and then forces a Hellfire, which gives him initiative to play the Tusk Rush Totemic on 5 mana.
I mean, these are the things he's thinking about, you know, 3 turns ahead. Like, how is this going to play out?
Right.
And that's what you have to do. So...
Are there other options, though? Like, can you...
Yeah. No, I think that's exactly how it plays out. Yeah. Based off... The fact that we have information makes it easy for us, but Life Coach is thinking about this. Shadow Bolt the 3-4, kill the 0-2, I play Feral Spirits, get the easy trade, he has the Hellfire, and then on 5 mana, I only have 2 remaining, so I can play Tusk Rush Totemic, or even Manatide Totem, which has justification, but then Manatide Totem plays into the Blackwing Corruptor, so I'll probably have to play Tusk Rush Totemic, which is fun, because you can even summon your own Manatide Totem as well.
Yeah. And...
I actually think, like, Jackie Chan, just in hindsight, Jackie Chan got a perfect matchup in the final versus Life Coach, because Life Coach is a player that needs to play a specific matchup 1,000 times to be able to map it.
Oh, yeah.
Jackie Chan
That's
brought
a good point.
Jackie Chan brought something super weird.
That's a really good point, Ed. I didn't think about that. I'm just like, how Life Coach is probably just, like, taking... I think part of the reason why he's, like, flubbing a lot here in the finals is because this deck's weird.
Yeah.
This deck is really unusual. It's like... You run a bunch of mid-range without actual burst finish. Like, most mid-range decks are supposed to have some kind of weird decisive way to kill you. Grommash Hellscream, Druid Force Nature Savage Roar. Yeah, something to kind of, like, decisively close out the game. But this deck just kind of, like, beats you to death.
Yep. Just hangs out with the minions.
Yeah, just kind of, like mid-range minions outvaluing you.
Yes, Life Coach is in the dark. Like, he's really trying to think hard what is going to happen every turn. And...
I don't think Squire changes the play at all. You just get such a clean snipe on Imgang Boss, one of the highest value minions against what you play. Everything you do plays into Imgang Boss. And maybe this base out Hellfire, although the pivot strategy could be the Twilight Guardian, but with a 4-1 on board on Tunnel Trog, it feels like Flame Tongue Totem is too easily destroying your board.
I think that's a decent Hellfire for sure.
If you can, even though you give your opponent initiative, if you can take a moment to reset the board while the Shaman's overloaded, you can really take advantage of that in the long run.
So now, let's see what Tusk Rush Totemic rolls. Hey, maybe even a Manatide.
Well.
Actually, you kind of want, like, Totem Golem. You already have Manatides at this point.
Yeah, Totem Golem would be the best.
Especially after Hellfire.
Is there a case for Manatide? I mean, if your opponent doesn't have the Blackwing Corruptor, that's pretty amazing that you can get Manatide to draw 2 cards.
But if they do, I don't know. I feel like there's so many things that punish Manatide.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, you have 2 in your hand. Yep. The rest, your resources beyond Tusk Rush Totemic aren't that great.
What about if, Squire Totem? Is that also valid at all?
I don't know about that one.
Squire Totem? Not really. There's either Mana Tide or Tusker Totemic. And there actually is no Corruptor here.
Yeah, no Corruptor. The call out. Saying, like, if you have it, you have it. But if I don't, I actually can just run away with this game.
So this is a resource battle. You can actually tap and Shadow Bolt this. But on the other hand, if you play a Twilight Guardian, Mana Tide Totem will draw two cards only for free mana. So it's like an Arcane Intellect. You shouldn't be that sad about it.
Yeah. I mean, a Shadow Bolt and Hellfire was used. It's already kind of like weird for the removals. Like, the removals that this deck has are very specific, and they're not that common. Like, once you have Siphon Soul and Shadow Bolt used, it's like there's not really that much. And Hellfire, that's it. And you have, like, Coil, I guess, but everything else is just minions.
Yeah.
So you have to use minion combat, whether it's through trading or, like, Blackwing Corruptor value.
And you will have targets in this deck that you want to target with Shadow Bolt.
Yeah, 3 health is like the sweet spot against Shaman.
All right, well, there's actually a lot of options here. Maybe he wants to play the second Mana Tide Totem. If he gets a Mana Tide Totem from Tusker Totemic and plays another one.
Free Mana Tide Totem?
What? Oh, the heartbreaker for Jackie.
Goodness.
I kind of like Argent Squire too, because you have forbidden.
Why?
Just play the third Mana Tide Totem.
Not like this.
I think Squire and Totem is perfectly fine here. I mean, for the meme, you can as well. All right, Tunnel Trog.
Yeah, Life Coach ain't about no memes.
That's awesome for Life Coach because Jackie Chan has the hero power, so if this is a resource battle, he would be able to outvalue Life Coach in the end. But
Jesus, dude.
Double Mana Tide Totem.
I kind of was just joking when I said he can just summon Mana Tide Totem with the Tusker Totemic. I mean, Lothar's pretty happy. But gives me a thumbs up. But at this point, it's like, how do you deal with this?
Slowly and one by one, I believe.
I guess you Shadow Bolt an Imp Gang boss. That's the only way to do it. Siphon Soul is just beyond terrible this turn.
But you go for the Mana Tide Totems, right?
Yeah.
Just need to cut down the draw. Like, if Shaman has more cards than you, you're going to lose for sure.
You're not beating 3 cards a turn. There's just no way. Yeah. I can definitely see the value of keeping a minion, clearing your minions and hoping things like Tunnel Trog doesn't get carried away. But you gotta kill the Mana Tide.
Oh, he's going for the Trog that has the biggest damage potential.
Okay, that's completely reasonable.
But then this really gives Life Coach an edge.
Ooh.
Master of Evolution.
He can... Oh, man. Hold on. So...
You can get a free thing from below this turn pretty easily.
Rockbiter, Flame Tongue gives you good trades into everything on the board. And then that gives you 4 mana. I mean, hero power thing from below. Maybe Master of Evolution on the Argent Squire. Master of Evolution on the Argent Squire is not bad at all either.
No, it's terrible. You can get Doomsayer.
Yeah, so let's just never play Pilot Shredder in our deck, shall we?
It becomes terrible.
It's so much better to Master of Evolution that thing from below, though.
Okay.
And get a 7-7.
Yeah,
I don't mind Thing from Below here, or even Mana Tide Totem and Thing from Below.
Yeah, Thing from Below is fine. Definitely not Master Evolution.
Master Evolution could also be disastrous.
Jackie Chan's trying to summon his Hellfire with these hand motions.
Dude, if you get Hellfire, he's completely back in this game. Although you draw 2 cards in the Mana Tide.
If there is no Hellfire,
no, he can tap for it.
Look.
Can,
oh my
he
goodness.
He can coil and tap for it. That's probably pretty important.
But there's only one in his deck.
What about getting Siphon Soul?
There's one in his deck, and he's got 19 cards remaining. So out of 3 draws, or sorry, 2 draws.
10% about?
Yeah. A little bit over that.
Is there anything else he can do without Hellfire? Like Siphon Soul to 7-5, then tag into Flame Tongue, I guess, to coil it. But... The Mana Tide Totems are going to destroy you.
Still drawing 2 cards a turn.
I probably Mortal Coil and Blackwing Corruptor 0-3. Siphon Soul still feels like doesn't give you freedom. You're still leaving up like a Mana Tide either way, and then
wait. So Corruptor does 0-1 of the Mana Tides.
Probably
and
the
coil
one,
the free one.
Yeah, probably remove everything to the right side of the Mana Tide, just so that way it's like.
And you will get 10 damage to face.
Yeah. Coil, right, coil
Is that a Hellfire? Nope.
No.
Just a Farseer.
I guess you have to go for this Corruptor then.
Yeah.
And then shoot the... Oh, Flame Tongue.
He's going for Flame Tongue because Flame Tongue is too much damage on board.
At this point... Well, I mean, if you isolate it to the far right, but at this point it's like... He's drawing so many cards.
Valiant.
That's 12 damage and good trades. I don't even know. This is looking brutal for Jackie Chan, but I feel like I've said that in every single game that he's won. So.
Yeah, it's, you know, I wonder if Hellfire is actually still okay. I don't think it is as much.
It's not the best.
Drawing three cards a turn, just, I mean, Warlock Hero Power is insane to help you draw two cards per turn.
Yeah, Life Coach can just continue trading.
And now you have something that does even better than that for free. So, and those things can attack you.
Yeah. And they grow.
This one's gotten a bit out of control.
Yeah, absolutely. Is he just going for face, setting up lethal? Next turn? Well,
I mean, how does Jackie Chan deal with it?
Chilmo and a dragon, maybe?
Yeah, but then... Life Coach can dictate trades. He's got Thunderbolt Valiant.
Oh, yeah. There is a hex, obviously, right? For the Shield.
It's true. And he's drawing two more cards. Mana Tides are just too insane. And Jackie is looking at certain death in the next turn. He can trade both and then siphon solo 3-6. But guess what? The Mana Tides still stay on the board.
That's actually 7 damage. And Fire Elemental will be 10. You heal for free. So, technically, he's not dead yet.
But it's very close.
Yeah, that's not a good life. He had a good run.
Jackie had an amazing run. And it's not, like you said, it's not over yet, but I think the Cinderella story is about to turn into a pumpkin here. I think the clock's striking midnight. Jackie came in here not really competing in many tournaments other than ACT. Kind of just stuck to his stream, climbing ladder, doing really well with fantastic, fun decks. But sometimes you fall a little bit short.
Yeah.
It's still awesome, bringing his own decks.
6, 8, 9, 2 off right now.
Unless he gets Flame Tongue.
Yep. Could also Master Revolution your...
It's got 10.
Your minion for a charger.
Or you could Tuskar for Flame Tongue.
Tusker for Flame Tongue. A lot of possibilities
is
here.
Is it Flame Tongue plus 2 attack? Nope. Well, right, you're still an awesome.
You just use Siphon. I kind of like either Fire Elemental or 7-7. Just play one of those two.
You can just put them on one.
You can put them on one as well.
Eliminate the life tap.
No life tap.
There's so many winning plays here. You just have to find that. Find the one that wins the most.
It's sweet spot.
You're trying to find the difference between 100% win rate and 97%.
Yep.
You know, like one of those things where, like, is there any way? Is there any possible way I lose this game? And he says, not if I trade down this board and play a huge minion. Like the Frameless Faceless.
Yeah. Especially after seeing the Siphon Cell as well.
You have Healing Totem, heal it back up.
So.
And unless Jackie Chan has Yogg-Saron all of a sudden. No, he doesn't have enough mana.
Yeah, he doesn't even have the mana.
Okay, let's see his last card.
If you're out there, give Jackie Chan a Yogg-Saron. We know you have the power.
Last chance, Jackie. Sunwalker.
Not
no
really.
Bueno.
Nope.
He'll can it up.
Do you consider you play Chilmo?
He's going to play Sunwalker, but the Hex is going to do it.
Is Sunwalker even enough? It's not even...
Sunwalker blocks 2.
You're still dead with Sunwalker.
Yeah, no, you're 14, so you'd be one above lethal based off what you see on the board.
All right, so you're not dead on board.
Right.
You're still hopeful.
But we know that the Hex is coming in, and we have ourselves a champion for CSR Cup 5. It's gonna be Life Coach from G2, taking it on homeland soil in Germany.
Oh man, Life Coach, another championship. How does he do it? How does he do it? It's another great winner for the Story Cup. Congratulations to Life Coach.
Yeah. Big congrats to Life Coach.
The team is waiting for him, hugging thighs at the very moment. Lothar looking like a proud father.
Yeah.
Jackie as well. Oh man, such an amazing tournament. Great winner.
Wow, congrats. Actually, take the headset.
I think that's all right.
There's another one.
Yeah. There we go. Headsets for everybody.
All right. So, Life Coach, congratulations on your victory. You are the fifth person to take a Sea Story Cup. What's it feel like right now, man?
Very good. very exhausted.
Are you like, tired? Yeah, I was about to say, man.
What time is it? 3:30.
Yeah, 3:30. There you go. Yeah. You know how to bring us to the brink, man. That's crazy. I mean, against Jackie, it's kind of a crazy opponent too, right? So it felt like the series had to go to 7 games to make it really dramatic.
Yeah, the semifinals and the finals were just insane, right? Like, twice, and it was not only because it's like me, right?
Right.
It's like, they went to 7, they went like, they prolonged very, like, was it like over 2 hours, right? Each of the series.
Yeah. You versus Tyson 2 hours.
Is that your standard? Is it the no, time no, you're trying
it's
to
not,
get?
No, okay,
it's not. Quite above average, I'd say.
It's like, all right, I'm going to play an awesome match. It's going to be 2 hours plus.
Yeah.
What have you felt when you lost versus with your Hunter? Because with that Shadow Bolt and he killed you with Finley and with PO, was that something that scared you? Because it seemed similar to how RDU won versus you at Insomnia.
Oh, really?
So you were like, you know, just the cards from Dark Peddler basically killed you in that one moment.
Yeah, to be honest, I thought like I already had the game in my pocket, so
yeah.
it didn't particularly feel good because I was really like thinking, oh, the victory is just a little bit ahead, and then like bam, 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 and I'm like, yeah, right.
Just mouse the Huffer over to the face.
And what did you think coming with the Shaman into the Warlock? Did you think you have an edge, or were you uncertain about the matchup?
No, I think it's like super dependent. Like if he gets his Doomsayer off early, usually this blocks enough so that he can get his Blackwing Corruptor answers. Hellfire can also be deployed very well, so I really had to pay attention for the Hellfire Forge. I was even happy that the Hellfire went out so quickly because then I could simply overexpand. And that's also, like, I was thinking that's the only way to win. Like, if I simply overexpand and ignore Hellfire, but if you already use it, perfect. And turn 5, he was kind of unlucky that he didn't have the Blackwing Corruptor because, like, I was thinking that he only Hellfires with the Blackwing Corruptor as a follow-up. But, fortunately, he didn't have it, so fortunately, the Tusker was also... because, I mean, I don't play any Shaman, like, on Ladderer, so usually I always face this Tusker random mana type totem and cannot handle it.
So it felt good to be on the right side this time, right?
Justice.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. Can you talk about the value of bringing, like, these different strategies? Do you think it's a coincidence that two players who brought unusual strategies to the tournament end up getting to the finals and doing very well?
Interesting, yeah. I mean, you also 6-0 with the Conceit Champ, right?
So, yeah, I did.
I guess, maybe it helps. I mean, my perception is rather like that Jackie Chan is simply a very strong player. I mean, he proved it like many times being like rank one or finishing even rank one on ladder with like different kind of decks, which he also invented, which tells me that he's simply a strong player. So I guess it's rather due to the player than to the decks.
But you can play unusual stuff and do very well. I think that's like the point that was taken away from this tournament. A lot of people really love the creativity coming out from here.
Right. Yeah, I also enjoy it very much. Yeah,
yeah,
I mean,
absolutely.
Like, one big question. What is Lothar feeding you guys? Thijs wins European Championship, RDU wins DreamHack, you win Sea Story Cup.
Yeah, all three of them got top 8. And RDU got top 8.
Yeah, exactly.
Thijs in the top 4.
What is happening?
In the finals. And you can argue that if they didn't have to play each other, you might actually see an all G2
probably.
Yeah, very good G2 performance. I mean, that's for sure. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. It's really impressive.
I mean,
it
could not be better, right? Yeah. I mean, like, all of us only lost against each other, so it's like a perfect.
Yeah, and that's the way you go. Yeah. DJ, do you have anything you want to say to Life Coach before I send him off to the trophy ceremony?
No, man, just big congratulations. I got to cast your semifinal and your final.
Oh,
and
sick.
Probably two of the best competitive matches I've seen in a long time, so thanks for that.
Awesome. All right, Life Coach, you have the final words you say before we give you your trophy. So go ahead, say what you want to your fans, your family who's watching and here too, or anything else you want to say and thank you.
Mm-hmm. Well, like, I am having like a super great time here, and I would even say like probably one of the best, if not the best, tournament experience. Like, it's it really feels like a family here, and really chill out atmosphere. I never had any point where I feel like pressured into like time schedules or something, but it just implied that everybody does the best they can to make this event a success. And I already heard it it is kind of a success.
Yeah.
So
definitely.
That's awesome. Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm.
This event is truly special, and we have a special winner too. Congratulations once again, Life Coach, for taking Sea Story Cup 5. Applause from the caster couch as well as a little bit from behind us.
Awesome.
And that's we're done over here, so go on over and get your trophy, Life Coach.
Thank you very much.
In the meantime, guys, let's hop on over to the throne area to crown our rifle champion.
All right, guys, it's time to crown our champion. It was a great tournament, but we do have a champion. Life Coach, take a seat. It is yours. Give a huge hand to our champion, everybody. A huge hand. And this is your trophy. Hold it up high. Give it a huge hand, guys. Give him a huge hand. A well-deserved champion, of course. But we all know that the most important competition of the weekend was between Team Anubis and Team Horus. And obviously, Team Anubis got the win. And Life Coach now gets to receive the prize for Team Anubis. So Life Coach, why don't you go ahead, open the box, and hold up high what's inside. Hold up high what's inside. Hold it up high. It's a golden salt shaker. It's a golden salt shaker. Oh, what's happening? What's happening?